Welcome to, was this March?
March.
March meeting of the Inventors Association of Manhattan. And we have a great speaker tonight. For those of you that might be new to the room, we are an organization, a New York State not-for-profit, that believes in education and empowerment of inventors, startups, and entrepreneurs of all kinds. And we just hope that you find it a useful place to build a body of knowledge to make you more effective in launching a product. Each month we'll have a speaker, such as Dave tonight, who's a expert in the areas of various IP, and tonight's going to be speaking about monetization, which includes licensing and stuff like that. We also, if any of you have a product that you want to get some exposure on, we'll actually have time for what's called pitching panel, which is an opportunity to get exposure and feedback on a product, and we have a panel of experts that will assist you with that. As I like to say, it's our version of Shark Tank without the money, the drama, or the billionaire ego. But I think Lewis is approaching that level.
At least on the ego, but not the billionaire.
What? No. And by the way, thank you to Lewis and David for last month filling in. I wasn't here. Literally woke up Thursday morning without a ticket to Germany. And by Friday night, I was on a plane to Germany, so that was something that came up suddenly. I apologize for missing any confusion that occurred last month. And with that, I want to thank everyone. Brought back a little treat. These are those little chocolate filled with some sort of liqueur. So we're going to pass this around. Please feel free to take one. And I hope it makes it to the back of the room.
From Germany?
From Germany, yeah. And my name is Bruce Zutler. I'm the president of the association, and I'd like to welcome you all here this evening. Our speaker tonight is David Pastowski.
Correct.
After a year, I think I got it.
Uh-huh. Here you have it.
And it's great because we have a lot of wonderful professional members, and they all have a passion, and Dave especially has a passion for what he does and really cares about inventors and believes in this mission of education and empowerment. And I think your speech tonight is going to cover a lot of different topics that I think a lot of us care about is this monetization issue. And I think
you supported and
thank you for acknowledging me. Yeah. So you get away 1 month and
yeah,
I fall
you
apart.
Forgot it all.
but yes, we'll get into that in a second. And I mentioned professional members, and we do have some here this evening, so why don't we start with Gordon, stand up and mention a little bit about what you do.
I'm a product designer, and I do design, development, engineering of your products. That's what my company is all about. My work is in the Museum of Modern Art, so I do know what I'm doing. And if you're interested, there's a couple of articles on my website. One is called Choosing a Product Designer, and the other one is called Working with a Product Designer. They're on page 2 of my website, which is at grpd.com. I encourage you to read it at your leisure, and speak with me when you like to. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon. And Bill. Bill has not been here too frequently, but he is one of our professional members, and I'd like to formally introduce you and thank you.
Been a little nutty at the office lately. My name is Bill Samuels. I have a small IP firm. Four attorneys, and we are a full-service IP boutique. We work with a lot of startups and entrepreneurs.
And Louis Del Judas, who is also our host here. Thank you, Louis.
Welcome, everyone. I'm a partner here at Trotman Sanders. We're a pretty big firm, a pretty big group. We specialize in all form of regular law and IP law. We may not be the right size for everyone, but we can direct you in the right direction if necessary. But I'm always happy to have a conversation or help or have a chit-chat about whatever's going on. So feel free to give me a call or stop me during one of the meetings and we can talk.
Thank you, Lucas. Any others that I missed? So with that, and it is making its way up front, and oh my God, everyone gets one. That's good. With that, David.
Thanks.
Please.
Hi, everyone. So if you don't know me, my name is David Pastowski. I work at Dave Pitney. I've been with Dave Pitney for about 2 years. Prior to that, I was in-house counsel at Cantor Fitzgerald. They had a division called the Innovation Division. It was their way of getting into the patent world in a very stealth manner. So Cantor's made up of 54 different companies, and we were the in-house counsel for all those different companies. Very diverse patents we worked on and everything. And so from that experience of kind of being on the other side, being on the client side, kind of helped me in my experience today at Dave Pitney, where I sit in various departments, which is not really what happens at law firms, right? Some people sit in the patent department, some people sit in the trademark department. I sit in both, and I also sit in the corporate department. So in the corporate IP department. So the reason why I wanted to do this presentation was because I've been noticing over the last year and a half since Dave Pitney has been kind of back on as a professional sponsor, but there's been a lot of questions about, you know, I have my patent now. You know, how am I going to make money off this? What do I do? Like, why isn't it so? How come it's not so easy? Like, all of a sudden I have my patent. People should be knocking down my doors, right? And so this is really meant for you to kind of give you some options, give you some education, what you need to be looking out for when it comes to patent monetizations, not just patent monetization, but also trademark monetization, as well as just, you know, trade secret monetization, as well as, you know, just if you have a service that you want to provide to somebody. So there's a lot of information on the slides. If I don't cover anything, it's not meant so much for me to cover it. You can have the slides afterwards. I don't mind. You can have it. And so there are things that I may not go over. That's okay. But really, this is so at the end of the day, you can leave the room with some options as to what you can do with your intellectual property and or product, service, or technology. Cool? I kind of wanted everyone to come prepared with questions because I wanted to do it a little bit differently, maybe somehow be interactive. Because I've been noticing also this, during the meetups, there's some questions that are never answered. So I want to make sure that all your questions are answered. So if at any time you want to interrupt or what, please do. Does anybody have any questions now? Like in general? Okay, good. Let's see if this works. Okay. So you have a company, right? First thing you should, how many of you hold patents, by the way? Like actual patents, not provisionals? Awesome. How many of you have entered into licensing agreements with anybody? Nice, Rick. Anybody else? No? Okay, so for those of you who don't have patents, I wanted to start with this, which is you need some type of intellectual property strategy here, right? I'm sure you all know that intellectual property is your number one asset, right? It's what your company is going to be valued at. It's something. If you want to exit out of this company, if you want to exit out of this startup, you need to realize certain things, right? You need to realize that once you get your patent, you are responsible for maintenance fees, right? Anybody know what maintenance fees are? What are maintenance fees?
They're required fees by the patent office to keep your patent alive.
Right. So when you want to monetize your patent, you have to be responsible for some of these fees. So they get pretty expensive, right? If you are a large entity, small entity, by the 11th and a half year, you have to be prepared to pay certain of these fees if you're not going to license one of these rights away to an existing company. So you're in it for the long haul is what I'm trying to say. You need to think about this. You need to think about who your competitors are, who are potentially going to be opposing you, who are potentially going to be infringing you. And this is stuff that should have came out when you do your patent search with your patent attorney, right? All of you have done patent searches, right? Who here has done this patent search? Great. And so one of the benefits of that is you know who your competitors are, right? You know who potentially can be your opposition when you have your patent and when you're ready to monetize. So, sorry about that. Okay, so another thing is, how many people have provisionals? Okay, so provisionals, my friends, provisionals do not get examined. Everybody understands that, right? I mean, there is nothing worth anything with a provisional. Would you agree? Yeah, I mean, you have to file your application, and your application has to then become a patent, right? So and the reason why I'm saying this is because we have a lot of clients that come in with provisionals, and they're like, can you get me a licensing deal on the provisional? No, There is no licensing deals on provisionals. Very few situations where a company is going to license your provisional and take on all the developmental costs and all the production costs and all the manufacturing costs. Very few opportunities like that. Lewis, do you know of any opportunities like that?
No.
Yeah, it's tough, right? You need your patent, right? You need your patent. So, and not only does the patent, not only do you need the patent, but the patent shows the potential licensee or licensor or the company that you're going to be doing business with that you have a stake in the game. A provisional costs you, what, $5,000? It has not been examined by the patent office. So you need to have something that when you are approaching an entity, they know that you have one stake in the game, right? Two, that you've spent money on this. Three, that it's been examined by the patent office and that they've actually made a ruling on whether it's patentable or not. That's not going to happen with the provisional. You also have to know your IP's value. So how much are you going to sell your product for? How much are you going to license your product for? What are other people in the market selling their products for, licensing for? What is the going royalty rate? The reason why I put this up here, the federal district courts do not set your value. It's because they don't. So if you're going to potentially have a patent that's going to be that if you're going to have a patent, somebody is going to bring a patent infringement lawsuit against you. You have to be prepared with what that patent could potentially have made had it gone through a licensing structure, right? So you have to know how much you're going to sell your patent for, how much is it per unit, how much are the manufacturing costs. If somebody's going to bring a suit against you, or you're going to bring a suit against somebody else, the federal district court who is going to be reviewing that patent infringement case, they're not going to set the value for you, right? They're not going to say, oh, you would have sold your application, you would have licensed your patent at, you know, a 5% rate at, you know, $5 million per year or something like that. They don't do that. That's not their function. They're there to just rule on infringement. Okay, questions? Exactly. Well, that's. I think that's the point. I think you. Part of the IP strategy is to also make sure that you are knowing who your competitors are, who your industry is, knowing that if you're going to spend $15,000 on your patent, what are the potential output of it? Did I answer your question? Kind of.
I think you're. Question is a really valid question. That's why an association like this is important, because IP strategy, what Dave had up there, should always be preceded by business strategy.
Right.
And a lot of, and I'm not trying to cast aspersions on any profession, but a lot of patent practitioners, unlike the people in this room, don't help a person understand why invest that much money and then not have a way to make money on your patent investment.
So we have to take care of that blind spot.
You should be aware of it. Absolutely. Very important point.
Yeah, I think, yes.
Just curious, on that fee for the patents every year or every couple of years, what happens if you don't pay it? The patent is invalid?
If you do not pay your maintenance fee, your application goes abandoned. And you have, what is it, 2 years to pay to come up with a good enough reason why you missed it, right? It has to be some type of unintentional reason or something like that. But I was saying that because if you aren't going to find your potential licensee by the third and a half year, you're responsible for those maintenance fees. So you need to take that into consideration, that it's just another fee for you to pay. And a lot of people think it's just going to end after the patent gets allowed. There's all these different fees, and it gets pretty expensive, Gordon. I mean, $7,400 for the 11 and a half year, that's a lot of money for a large company. For you, let's say it would be $3,700. Still, that's a lot of money, $3,700.
So what happens if you don't pay those fees?
So if you don't pay those fees, the patent goes abandoned. I think you okay, so The fee is due at the third, at the 3.5 year, 7.5 year, 11.5 year. You have 6 months from the 3.5 year, so it's due at the 4th year, due at the 8th year, due at the 12th year. If you don't pay, it goes abandoned. But if you have, if you had a good enough reason, you can bring a petition to revive within 2 years, right?
What's the critical point for an inventor then who maybe abandons is that it becomes public domain. And anyone could then implement that patent if it becomes an unmaintained patent. Is that correct?
Can they do that on a design patent?
Yeah, totally. But the, but for the design, it's a smaller term, right? For a patent, it's 20 years. For a design, it's 14 years.
I thought it was
17. A patent is now 20 years, right? 20 years. I mean, it used to be 17 years. Now it's 20 years.
Oh.
Yeah. But to your point, and I don't think that's correct. If somebody has maybe I misunderstood. So if you have a patent and it's due for its 3.5 maintenance fee and I don't pay it, you can't just swoop in and pay it and it becomes yours.
No,
yeah,
it becomes public domain. Anyone can practice what's included within that patent.
However, yes, but it would be prior art to the next.
They
couldn't do the exact same thing. Yeah.
They couldn't patent it themselves.
Yeah, they couldn't patent themselves and they would have to improve it and stuff like that. Yes.
What are the three numbers there?
So what I meant was, what I put up here was, this is a large entity, small entity, micro entity, large entity, small entity, micro entity, large entity, small entity, micro entity.
Okay.
What does that mean?
Large entity is a large company with over...
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I don't know what that means.
Yeah.
I what's the distinction between them?
Wow, she's one of my clients too. I thought we turned. Oh my God, no, that's my fault. Okay,
no,
so
a micro entity. I didn't know that there was a distinction. Obviously, there is, but
yeah.
I'm not exactly sure what it is.
Large entity companies over 500 employees make a lot of money, right? Big companies, right? Big
Google.
Pharmaceutical companies, Google, right? Small entity used to be the only other discounted entity rate that was out there. What is it? Under 50 employees or something? 50 employees.
Educational,
not-for-profit, and micro-entity is this new one that just came out, which is likely what all of you qualify for. Folks with under 4 patents, well, maybe not. Also, if you have a income level of under 3 times the amount of the national average, which is $50,000, so under 150K, if you have an income of under 150K.
You mentioned putting a value on your assets.
Yes.
And you mentioned finding out what the actual value of the competitor's licenses are in the marketplace. How would you access that?
So I actually have a slide later on. So there are licensing agencies. There are national licensing agencies that you can access and you can inquire. There are also industry agencies, right? So if you, depending on what your technology is, you go to the trade organization that runs your technology. Again, this is all generally speaking, right? Depending on your technology, depending on what the demand is for your patent or for your service or trademark, or whatever, it could change. You can have a 3% royalty rate, but Francine can have a 6% royalty rate with the same product. So it depends on what your market is, what your potential market is. But these are things that you should be thinking about.
And not generally public information.
Yeah, sure. I actually have some royalty rates coming up. Did you want to talk about some royalty rates that you've
I would say they're not public information that a company has to divulge what they're paying to a licensor, but it's fairly, they're common ranges that you'll see anywhere. You know, it could be as low as 0.5% for a very high volume, high price kind of item to, you know, 10, 12, 15% for popular brands like Disney or MLB, Major League Baseball, NFL, that sort of thing. So it's really all over the place.
You should also be thinking about if your patent is gonna be licensed in a foreign country, right? A lot of unfortunately, people need to make that decision whether they're going to foreign file very quickly into the life of their patent, right? Before they likely have even tested the market, made a prototype, or done anything. But it's something to think about, because if you are going to sign a licensing agreement with an international company, they're likely not, you are not going to be an attractive client to them if you don't have a patent to enforce in that country where you're producing or manufacturing or importing or exporting that technology or patent into. So you should be thinking about the international considerations of your product and whether it's even available or whether it could be available or have an international market. Trademarks. How many of you hold trademarks? Excellent. I thought there would be more. So I actually included some slides about trademarks, because with trademarks, it can become a very lucrative license as well. If you have risen your brand to a certain level, but it's all about use. Whether it's whether you are using your mark. No one is going to license anything from you or buy anything from you if you're not using the mark. If you've not shown, again, some stake in the game and whatnot.
I have a question about trademarks. How long are they good for?
Trademarks are good perpetually. They're good forever, as long as you continue to use it and pay a renewal fee every 10 years. Yeah, and copyrights is the life of the author plus 7 years. Another thing you need to think about, which is why provisionals are not that important, are the claims, right? It's all about the claims. It's all about the meat of the application. So an application is made up of a specification, right? Claims and abstract and drawings. The claims are your meat, right? Lewis had a whole session on this a few weeks ago on claim drafting and writing and strength of claims. That's something you must take into consideration when you're thinking about a license. That's what they're looking at. That's what a potential licensee, licensor is looking at. They're looking at the claims, whether they can stand up in court, and whether what you are claiming can actually be, that what you are claiming covers the product that you are trying to license.
How does the claims that you just mentioned interface with a design patent as opposed to the utility patent?
So there's only one claim in a design patent, right? It's just the ornamental design of the name of the design. it doesn't. That statement was just for patents. But with the design, I mean, hopefully your drawings. Hopefully you have enough views and it shows your drawings correctly. You know, you should have. You know, up, down, left, right, back, forward, you know, you should have it fully covered. Okay, Bruce always says, not everything is patentable, right? anyone want to guess why I put these three companies up there? What do these three companies have in common?
They're trade secrets.
Yeah, right?
Secret recipes.
Right, so secret recipe, Coke's formula, Google search algorithm. They don't own patents on these things, right? They don't own trademarks. Well, they have trademarks. They don't own design patents. They don't have utility patents, non-provisionals on these. But yet this is intellectual property. These are considered trade secrets. And I bring this up because not everything is patentable, right? And again, Bruce says it all the time, but not everything has to be patentable. You can keep it a secret. And trade secrets, like any other area of IP, is licensable, right? People will buy it from you. People will license it from you. However, some clear cons about trade secrets. Once it's in the public domain, we'll use the example of Coke. If Coke's formula was in the public domain, and somebody tried to recreate it, which we see all the time, right? Pepsi tried to recreate it, RC tried to recreate it. There's nothing they can do, right? Coke cannot bring a lawsuit against Pepsi for trade secret infringement, right? So if it was discovered and they tried to reverse engineer it, then there's really nothing they can do about it. Yeah, I mean, that's a pretty broad statement, but for all intents and purposes, there's nothing they can do about it.
Just to add to that real
yeah.
quick, this is a true story. Somebody tried to sell Pepsi Coke's trade secret, and Pepsi told Coke, and they called like the feds or something like that, and got them arrested.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. And because one of the mainstays about trade secrets is that if you can prove some theft, right? I'm not sure what the exact facts of the case was, and Lewis helped me know anything about the case. But if I'm not mistaken, Coke was trying to say that somebody at Pepsi stole something from. Like, I guess he used to be an employee of Coke,
right.
Stole it, and stealing the form, like stealing the trade secret, is one of the things that you can try to protect against if you have a trade secret. So you should try to. You know, keep it under lock and key and bury it under the ground and make sure that nobody gets to it. No, really, they take, you know, people, from what I understand, Coke is like somewhere in the middle of America, you know, buried in a safe somewhere, and so the fact that somebody possibly stole it, yeah, and maybe had gone to Pepsi with it, then yeah, that's a good lawsuit to bring. Okay, licenses. So there, I have a lot of slides on licenses, and you can take them back. So there's how many know the difference between who's if you're a licensor or a licensee? Right, so you all own the IP, so you are the licensor, right? You're the one, so you want people to purchase a license from you, so you're the licensor. You want potential licensees. So there's a lot of slides that are coming up, and I'm not going to get into each one of them, but you can definitely have them to take home. Things that you should be thinking about if you're going to get into a license agreement with somebody, whether it's a patent or a trademark. I'm sorry, was there anyone who had gone into a license agreement here? Rick, do you want to talk about your experience a little bit? Good, bad, ugly?
It was a nightmare.
Nightmare. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Did you make money?
No.
Oh, yeah. Why?
It was about a year and a half of my life.
Why didn't you make
it
money?
It was just the guy ended up being a compulsive liar and couldn't tell the truth on the bet, and I don't know if he had the capabilities or the intention to ever do what he said he was going to do, which was to produce the product and market it. So it dragged on and on. Finally, I informally got out of it. I mean, he just wouldn't communicate with me anymore. So the takeaway from that is be careful who you get in bed with. You know, make sure you're both on the same page and that you trust, you know, the person you're dealing with or the company you're dealing with. Because I had some qualms at the beginning and I should have heeded them.
I should have went with them. There is somebody else here that also has a nightmare story, and I'm going to call on her to talk about it, because I would rather you know these stories than listen to me. It's important that you know the nightmares that are out there. There are people looking to prey on inventors, right? There are people, there are companies who want to take advantage of your product, technology, patent, whatnot. And we'll promise to say and do things just like Rick said. So at least after this session, you'll hopefully know some of the terms to look out for. There are some key things in license agreements that are what we call pro-licensor terms, right? There are pro-licensee terms. But you can bet, because you are a small inventor, that any large company that you're going to get involved with is likely going to try to take advantage of you and try to get as much from you as possible in terms of rights, in terms of the actual rate they're going to pay you, in terms of territory, in terms of what things you will do as a licensor to breach the agreement. They have reciprocal duties as well, but you know, if you are going to go into it without an attorney, you at least should know what to look for. If you had an attorney, we would at least be able to negotiate these things back and forth. Whether we get any changes to the license agreement, that's not even the point at that juncture. It's that they know that they can take advantage of you. And it happens everywhere, actually.
An overarching comment to anyone getting into a licensing discussion. Most people I meet say, what's the rate? You know, they want to know, how much am I going to get paid on a percentage basis? And I would just have to say that the most important thing in a licensing agreement isn't the rate. There are many, many more covenants that are part of it, such as, you know, exclusivity. I hope I'm not taking...
No, go for it.
Exclusivity, defining the class of trade. You know, there are a lot of clauses that really will make your agreement strong or not. What kind of minimums must they perform to each year? The rate could be so secondary in some ways to what those protections are other than rate. So
yeah, I agree. No, there is a slide about all that. What I wanted to say was this never ends. This doesn't end just because you are a small inventor. I have a client that licenses 140 trademarks a year from Disney and from Warner Brothers, and they're a clothing manufacturer. They make shirts and caps and hats and stuff like that, and they license 140 trademarks, so they're the licensee, right? So they're up against Disney and Warner Brothers and the NFL, and my God, you should see how much those companies try to limit the amount of protection and rate that that my guy wants, right? So he's the licensee. He's licensing the trademarks from them. So they really try to get him. No matter what they try to, you know, limit the term. They try to say to him that you can only sell to us, and you know, meanwhile Disney wants the ability to serve everyone, but they want you to just to work with Disney. And so there's a lot of things to think about, and it doesn't end. Francine, we'll come to you in a second, but I'm sorry, yes?
I just had a question for the gentleman with the license agreement. How are you paired? Are you paired through a broker or on your own?
I did it on my own. It was a contact that just happened, and he expressed an interest in my product, and one thing led to another. But I noticed that I didn't heed the first bullet point on that slide, which was, you know, really investigate who I was dealing with.
Yeah.
Personal references and so forth.
Yeah. Listen, we live in this world today that as soon as you're going to put your product, service, technology up on the internet, you will likely get a phone call from a licensing broker or company willing, you know, they want to put you on TV, or they want to, you know, maybe they're part of, I hate to use him, but that the one, the speaker that we had to get you.
All-Star Mark.
Yeah. As seen on TV and whatnot. So, you know, those are folks that are looking to license your products, technologies, patents, and you really need to do your due diligence, right? You really need to know who they are, how many licenses have they signed a year. Ask them these questions, right? Especially if you're not going to use an attorney. If you're going to use an attorney, leave it up to the attorney, let them do all the negotiations. Hopefully you'll be involved in it as well. But if you're not, you should be asking every question under the sun. You should be asking for sample licenses. And if they don't want to give you that information, well, don't work with them, right? It's not worth it. It's not worth it to potentially sign away all of your rights to your patent or your trademark or what, and then not be able to get out of it, which was a good segue for you. But if you want to talk about your story, I think it's important because it's a very, the company is Edison Nation, right? Edison Nation, I don't know if any of you have been contacted by Edison Nation. I see Patrick putting his hands over. Do you have a comment about Edison Nation?
No, it's
probably put back then, memories, I hope.
No, not at all.
So Edison Nation, bad, I mean, notoriously bad. Francine did not let me know about it, and so we had to backpedal out of it. But they're an HSN preferred, well, they say they're an HSN preferred company, right? But they're not, right? So really got to be aware of things like that. You want to talk about Edison Nation if you can. Edison as in Thomas Edison, HSN as in Home Shopping Network.
Edison
yeah.
Nation.
Yeah.
But, Dave, I think without necessarily picking on a
no, but,
company in particular,
yeah, that's not
because you're on tape and you know you might be.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Okay.
Well, I don't really care, but but without saying their name.
Okay, well, we already said their names.
Yeah, erase
yeah.
it.
The moral to
memories.
The story, and David slapped me upside the head pretty hard about it, was that you have to be aware and pay attention to, you know, who you're dealing with and what you're doing. And I was doing a search on the internet about licensing, trying to understand a little bit more about the viability. I have a prototype and a product. It's a liquid carrying case. It's for women. It's a liquid carrying case to bring personal liquids on an airline. It's very beautifully designed, very pretty case. It's not really a good fit for like Kickstarter, which is very male dominated. So trying to figure out how I'm going to get it developed, and came across this search very prominently advertised Home Shopping Network, perfect target market for my product, and went on there and did some research on Edison Nation. I didn't actually come up with anything negative about them, so
right.
I didn't know anything about them. They must have a very good reputation management company, you know, because there was nothing negative that I saw about them. So I submitted in the information on there. At the very bottom of the last page, there was apparently, which I missed it, a link at the very bottom that said Inventors Agreement. It was a link to an agreement, which is at the very bottom, scrolling all the way down, and I didn't even see it. Submitted everything in. Needless to say, didn't think anything about it. 3 days later, I'm contacted by them because Home Shopping Network saw the product, saw the video, and they're interested and get really excited about Home Shopping Network because it's a perfect target market. And then, of course, I went back and I tried to figure out exactly what it was that I actually agreed to by submitting it in, and I got really scared when I saw that agreement. Then I reached out to my attorney after the fact and told him what I had done, and he asked me if I had signed anything. I didn't actually sign anything, but apparently it's one of those passive agreement things. So long story short, I had to very quickly remove my application to it because they assign over the rights. They give me a very small upfront fee of like $2,500, which is about the cost of one prototype. I have three prototypes, not to mention the design and development fees. And then they wouldn't even tell me what their rate was for licensing it out, and they were just really heavily courting me, and I got really scared. Long story short, I extracted it out, and they flipped out, and then had to get my attorney involved, because they really started to get very aggressive about it.
Yeah, well, in all fairness, I'm sure this has worked out for a lot of people. I'm sure that they have done great deals with other people. I've known some successful deals that they've done. The moral of the story is due diligence, read everything, don't sign anything until you really read it. I mean, that's...
I think just to add to that, Dave, with some of these patent brokers, there are a couple of things that I've seen that they tend to work off of volume. It's a numbers game. They want to get as many in their portfolio as possible. They don't know what's going to hit. They don't know if it will hit. And they tell you they think it will hit, but they don't know. And not just Edison Nation, but I don't know how they operate. So, but
this apparently went right out to join Mangan.
And that's what happens is they send out anything they get in. It's a numbers game, and they want to get that volume going. The other thing is that you want to be careful of any organization that wants to control it, because you don't have the visibility then to how the deal or what the deal is, and they at their discretion are sharing with you that information. So it's your IP. You should maintain control of it. It's okay to use middlemen or, you know, some kind of service providers, but you should be aware and visible to the entire process.
Now, long story short, they got very aggressive about it when I tried to remove it, which I eventually did. So
but they removed it, yeah.
Yeah, that did involved.
That was actually the next slide. Yeah.
Patrick.
Could I just ask, were you charged any money up front?
Only a $25 fee to submit it in.
Okay. So a $25 fee is what you were charged up front, and they were willing to manufacture, commercialize, get you a deal with HSN. I think that, in fairness to the company we've named, that's not
actually,
really defined as an
adventure. I yelped at her, Patrick. I told her this was partially her fault.
No, I'm not saying fault, but I'm saying that just out of awareness for the group, there are companies that will charge you $12,000 and promise you a licensing agreement. Edison Nation does not engage in that behavior.
Right.
No.
And so that's why I wanted to know what their fees are.
They actually weren't saying that they wanted to manufacture. They know the cost of the molds. I know the cost of the molds too. They actually wanted it to go back on Kickstarter and get the cost of the molds from Kickstarter.
You
can
hold your IG, you can withdraw whatever you
want. I absolutely did.
But the idea is that you weren't short $12,000.
Right.
Oh, I would
right.
never have done that.
Yeah.
And I think to your point, Patrick, at the right time in the right place, it might be the best of all the alternatives that you might have explored.
Yeah, she decides if it's a good deal or not a good deal.
Right.
But at least you're not fronting up front costs.
Right.
That's the important
thing. Yeah, and it actually brings up another point, which is that there are different levels of licensing, right? You can get someone to license the manufacturing part or the distribution part, or maybe to do the prototyping or do the Kickstarter. So all of these, so if anyone's gonna offer to do any services for you and you already have your IP in place, you need to have a license in place. That's what a license is. It is the right to use something, right? So
If I can address that, they actually did offer something very significant. If I had chosen to go the Kickstarter route, they actually offered to do all the publicity for it, to take on all the PR and the publicity for it. That's a very significant thing.
Yeah.
I would agree.
I don't think it was a bad deal. I just think it was just...
I just think
it needed to be better informed, that's all.
Think it was a bad deal.
Anyway. I'm sorry? Oh, how is your liquid case doing?
well, we're still trying to get it commercialized, so.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that I regret not taking it, because I don't regret not pursuing it.
Yeah, it's going to do great.
David, I think we have a question in the back.
Sorry.
On your last slide, it's
said that if IP is unproven, can you consider phasing with a large company? What is
Ah, that's kind of what I meant before. So the very rare example of if you, let's say, have a utility application, you have a non-provisional application, or maybe even a provisional application. I'll give an example from my real life. I have a client who came up with a new instrument for detecting strep A in children, and filed the provisional. She had some interest from Johnson & Johnson. They did say to her, well, you know, you should come back to us when you actually get your patent. But she's very persistent about it, so we filed the utility, filed the non-provisional, and she hasn't gotten the patent yet. But she went back to them and she said, listen, I don't have the resources to do product testing, I don't have to do product packaging, I don't have the resources to take it to a lab, just kind of to your point. So you can actually license those rights to a lab or to Johnson & Johnson. So they were able to license the IP as an application, and they would take over the feasibility studies that she had to go to, maybe, and hopefully the product packaging. So it's kind of all in development now. But she does not have her patent yet, right? But she still wants control, and she wants the rights over her application that she filed. So there are different stages that you can license away.
What happens if she wouldn't have got the patent?
So we don't know. So she doesn't have the patent yet, right? So hopefully she'll get the patent in about a year. But they're willing to take that. They're willing to take that on. They actually believe in the product, and you know, they have their own labs and they have doctors, and she doesn't. She's not a nurse, not a doctor. She's just a school teacher. She had to give up a significant portion of her rights, and you know, but it was worth it for her. You know, it turned out to be a really good deal. So one of the benefits about going with a law firm, it's really who your contacts are, right? I'm not saying it's all about that, because she did a lot of hitting the pavement, right? She identified the 9 top pharmaceutical, kind of quasi-pharmaceutical companies like Johnson & Johnson or a few others that make you know, quasi-medical products, you know, thermometers, stuff like that. So that they can email and stuff like that, because this is a strep test. And she wrote out to them directly, and she actually submitted, you know, online some of them. She didn't get any responses, and Johnson was actually one of our clients, so we helped her with that. But if it wasn't for her submission a year before that, she probably wouldn't have even been considered, you know? Yes?
We all know that person, right?
No, she does. She's not. She's. She doesn't. She's not involved in this group. Yet.
No, not here. I meant on the market.
Oh no, it hasn't made it to market yet. It's still. It's actually still in feasibility and prototype.
There's another teacher who also.
Oh, is there for a strep test? Oh God, really?
It's airborne.
Thank you, airborne. Oh yeah, yeah. Is that strep A?
Yeah.
This is for like strep A, like you know that test that you
gag
on. You know. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you, if this person, the one who did the strep test, when she had gone to Johnson & Johnson, if she'd been a better saleswoman and better research, maybe she should have been able to get them to commit to her then and to kick on a patent then. Because the truth is, it was a really good product.
Yeah.
Johnson & Johnson knew that. They have to know that.
Yeah, you're right. And the way she did it was through their online process. Maybe not the best way to get to the R&D folks, right? Because they probably see hundreds of things. Maybe if she went about it a little bit differently. I'm sure, listen, there are success stories of inventors going directly to companies and companies accepting their products, even at a provisional stage. Right, and she isn't either, and really lawyers aren't either, right? I mean, some of us aren't, but then you have to go to people like Bruce, and you have to go to people who have some experience with some of these companies that they could also get into negotiation with you and get into negotiation with them and.
The point that I think you're making is, you know, not only is it sales, but it's about if you have an early stage patent without a lot of proven implementation knowledge, it makes it harder.
Yeah.
and you have to rely upon your ability to really spin a story and, you know, spin in a positive way. So, and I think Dave is going to perhaps say this, licensing a patent or any kind of IP is really about almost selling a business. And the more you can wrap around that IP, I like to call it the other side of IP, that's the implementation plan, the more likely you're going to have a richer negotiation, and the earlier you can get them to do something. So in the case of... Excuse me?
When you go in that door, you want them to sign then.
You know, I think there's a point of practicality and reality, and yes, from a sales point of view, if you're a great salesperson and you're able to get them to do it, I think that's good, but that's going to be an outlier. That's not going to happen.
Yeah. Yes, Lewis. Understand, though, what you say you want them then, yeah. That everything's a quid pro quo. It's a business, and they're going to say, okay, if you have an untested technology that you have invested in, you're going to have to give me a bigger piece of it. Because I'm just not going to give you the best rate you can, as if someone came to you with something that was fully formed, we've already done a test market, people, they flew off the shelves, now you have a position of power, right? So, as they said, you know, that woman had to give up a lot of her rights to get it early in the game. It's a business.
Yeah,
like
no,
anything
good
else,
point.
If they're a big business, they've got people doing it, or they may have people doing it. Or they can say to themselves, no offense to anyone, they can reverse engineer it. Why
mm-hmm.
don't they go to you early in the game? You may not have anything. It's one thing to say I've got an oil well and I'm generating oil. That's worth something. It's another thing to say I've got a piece of property and somebody tells me there's oil underneath.
Yeah.
Those are two different values.
Yeah, totally. I mean, she came to us with the provisional. It was a rudimentary drawing, and that's what she submitted to Johnson. Of course they didn't look at her. A year later... Yeah, totally. But a year later, she had gone to them already with having one doctor already create a makeshift prototype based on her application. So she had one or two proven cases, which was enough for them to kind of take it on. But it goes back to the first slide where you have to think about your business plan, right? IP is your greatest asset, has to be included in your business plan. How are you going to make money? How is this product going to monetize itself, meaning in the world, in the real world? How much are you going to sell it for? What's the membership fee? What's the registration fee? I don't know. If it's an app, you know, how is it all going to work out? Everybody knows, if you're going to pitch your product, you need a pitch deck, right? You need to come up with these numbers. They're all theoretical, but they're so important, right? They're so important for investors and for licensees to kind of hook onto. They want to know exactly how much money this potentially could make for them. And with that, you have to know how much you want to get out of it as well. You know, it has to be realistic, right? Can't be that you want to retain 75% of it and you are giving over to them, you know, $500,000 of costs for prototyping. What? You are not going to, you know, try, you'll get 5% of it, right? Because they're going to put all their money into it. Quid pro quo, for sure.
Dave, this is a fascinating illustration.
So Lego is one of our clients at Dave Pitney. So they have this, they have these cool internal Lego pictures, and this is the slide I was talking to. That there's a lot of elements to a license agreement that you should be aware of. So whether the person who's licensing from you is going to be the exclusive licensee, the non-exclusive licensee, or the sole licensee, right? Those are all separate things. Whether they're going to do it, whether you're going to go into business with them, with just them, or whether you're going to have the freedom to go into business with other people, those are all important aspects. As well as what Bruce was talking about, your advances, right? How much are you going to get up front, right? In your case, it was $2,500 or something like that, right? So how much are you going to get up front, and then how do the royalties play out? How much are you going to get? And more importantly, you forget about the royalties, is how are the royalties going to be based? Is it going to be based on total sales of the product? Is it going to be based on net sales? Is it going to be based on sales minus defective products? Is it going to be on sales minus products that are returned because the customer doesn't want them? All that really matters and really changes the calculation a lot. So all to think about, right? Assignment, whether you allow the company or whether you're allowed to assign the rights to your application in any way. So for instance, let's say you we'll go back to the maintenance fee question. So you enter into a license agreement, everything's going well, you still have the responsibility of paying your maintenance fees. Let's say you want to assign that right to somebody. So you have to have, the license agreement has to allow you to have Bruce pay for those maintenance fees, right? If it says no assign, that's the most general example. But if your license agreement says you're not allowed to assign, then by virtue of somebody else paying your maintenance fees, you are in breach. So that's a big thing too. Licensees, remember you're the licensor, licensees are going to look for 1,000 ways for you to breach the license agreement, right? So you need to work in ways that they're going to breach the license agreement, right? So let's say your license agreement only covers the United States and Canada, and you're only allowed to ship through UPS or something like that. So you have to make sure if the license just says that you have to ship the United States and Canada, and the company that you have licensed with has subsidiaries in Europe and wants to ship to Europe, well, that's a breach, right? All these different things have to be researched, and you really have to know who you're getting into bed with, okay? I want to go back to the, there are ways for other people to pay your to pay your maintenance fees, which is a general example about licenses. Also, so depending on what your product is, right? So we'll go back to the trademark example right now. So my client who makes shirts and scarves and hats and stuff and uses Disney's trademarks. They're only allowed to use Disney's trademarks on those shirts and hats and stuff like that. They can't even take a picture of their product and put it on their website to sell it, right? Their license says you can only sell in Walmart, you can only sell in Target, and that you can't do anything else. So you can get really, really specific and nitty-gritty. So think about exactly what IP is covered, what everybody has a right to, what they're supposed to use. So back to having a business plan, one of the important things is that if you're going to enter into a license agreement and you are a small company, right? Does everybody have a company here? Everybody have a company and is your IP owned by that company? Yeah? Everybody? No. That's important, right? It's important that if you have a company and you want and that company is the if you want the company to reap the benefits of your patented or technology or trademark, it's important that the IP is assigned to that company, right? So it's an asset of the company and you're held, you know, not personally liable. That's an important aspect. So why is it important later on? And mind you, a lot of this won't come into play now, but it may come into play when you're successful and you're making a lot of money, and all of a sudden the person you're in business with says, you know what, we have the right to audit you, right? We have the right to see your financial books. We have the right to see exactly if you are making the sales you're making, or you do own the IP, or that the correct entity owns the IP. So all of these rights to audit have to be included in the license, as does your right to audit them. So just because you're the small guy here doesn't mean that you can't say, especially if you're making a license with Disney or something, or Google or something, you have those rights too. You have audit rights, and you have the exact same rights that the licensor has, but it's just since you're the small fish, they're going to want to, you have the exact same rights as the licensee, but because you're the small fish, they're going to try to take advantage of you and try to eat away at your rights, but you have to make sure that all your rights are enumerated. I really did not want to go through them all, but transfer fee, important one. So there's a term in a license agreement that says if you sell your company, right? So if you're a company and it owns your IP, and somebody has a license from you and you're doing rather well, and then somebody goes to buy your company, right? So that licensee has decided to do business with you, right? So they may be worked out in your license agreement that they don't want to do business with whoever you're going to sell your company to, right? So if you transfer that that license agreement, you may be in breach. It may not be, oh yeah, they're gonna love it, it's a big company, but that's not how it is. They wanna do business with you, and if they wanted the right to do business with another company, that they would say. And the same thing goes for you. If you're licensing to Disney, and Disney sells their company to Warner Brothers, you have the right to want that to happen, right? It doesn't have to be a given, right? So whether you transfer or not can determine whether you are in breach. Yes?
No.
Okay, warranties, covenants, also also very important. So there are certain rights that you have when it comes to when it comes to the license. So if you signed a license with, I hate to keep using Disney, but if you signed a license with Disney, it's usually for a specific term, right? It's usually for like a year, 2 years. So there may not even be a right to renew, right? So you have to think about that in terms of your business plan. If it all goes to hell, they're not going to want to renew. But there also might be an opportunity for them to buy the patent, to buy the IP from you. So it's what we call the right of first refusal, the right of first negotiation, the right of renewal. These are rights that you can build in to ensure that after a successful relationship with your licensee, that you give them first dibs on whether to buy the patent or buy the or buy the trademark from you or what. Sometimes this goes without saying, but a lot of times you are not a lot of times you don't have your patent yet, and so confidentiality is a big thing, right? Maybe it's still not published or whatever, so there should be confidentiality clauses. There also should be a best efforts clause. Like, these are things that big companies, sometimes the response is, well, of course we're going to use best efforts. Well, of course we're going to be confidential. No, you need to have those terms in your agreements. Don't assume that just because they are Disney. They're notorious for, I shouldn't keep picking on Disney. Disney's great. I love Disney. They're excellent. But, you know, they have a certain, you know, power that so sometimes they think that certain clauses shouldn't be there. But for your protection, they should be there, right? For your protection, you should have confidentiality, best efforts.
I think one of the important things, Dave, is with all of these clauses, you can't win and get every one of them.
Right.
So it's a matter of really understanding the nature of your product, understanding the nature of the market, understanding the financials, and choose your battles. Some of these may be more appropriate in other circumstances than others.
Right, right. The point is to have a conversation about all of these things. That's why you'll all have a slide to take home, but these are all really important. Again, not now maybe, especially. It's so easy to be desperate, right? It's so easy to just want to sign the agreement and start to make money. But these are things that you should not chintz on. They will come back to haunt you. And unfortunately, there are some licensees who are looking for that opportunity where you're gonna, you know, unsuspectedly breach something, and you don't want that.
I'm not sure you may be covering this somewhere else, but how do you find companies that would be interested in licensing your product? Because that happens with me often. Mentors come to me and say, well, I've got this great product. I don't want to make it, but I want to license this to someone. And I never quite know what to say about that, except good luck. But that's really not very Where do you find?
Well, one, you should say that. That's the first thing, right? And then say the next thing.
Well, actually, if I may, a great place to start, I tell anyone, if you're getting into any industry and you see you have a patent that may be or a trademark applicable for a company, is every industry has a trade show. And I'm sure many of you are sick of hearing me say that, but every industry has a trade show, and that's a great place to start. I personally had a fantastic experience licensing one of my patents that way. It was in the electrical products segment, and found the company at a trade show and developed the relationship that way. It's a warm contact. You're not just picking up the phone and saying, hi, I'm an inventor, I have this. You're making warm face-to-face contact, learning about the company, seeing what their product line is about, and you have a place to start. So the internet is wonderful. But I'd say getting into the real weeds of the industry is how you figure out who the right parties may or may not be
as licensing partners. And you could also see, by the way, that, I could tell, or you can get a sense that they have licensed in outside invention, too. So,
yeah.
When would be the best time to mention that you have a potential product that you would possibly like to go into a license agreement with if you thought that the company was agreeable and met your needs and was in the right position in the marketplace? Is that something that would happen like up front or...
That's such an it depends, and there's the art of the conversation, which leads to the art of the deal. And I think it has to do with also understanding what you have and how you position yourself as strongly as possible. You know, you don't want to appear to be an inventor who just came up with an idea in your garage.
Right.
It's what you have, once again, built into that IP. Are you just looking to have somebody take it off your hands? You know, it's like, well, then just go out and buy some lottery tickets. You know, you might have just as much success making some money that way, or do you have some implementation knowledge that's going to be of value that goes along with the patent? And it's how you present and who you use to help you present that could be valuable.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think it's important to know the implementation of your product and how it's built and how it works and how much it's going to cost per unit. These are things that some people come in with patents and but some of them have not even taken the time to recognize who their potential business partners would be or who their potential alliances might be. That's the first step. I mean, if you want to get an attorney to do that, why? I mean, that's just throwing away money. You should be doing that. You should be knowing who your potential partners are and who's your competition. And you know, it's one of the reasons why you did your patent search, right? You should be taking those results and you should be seeing who potentially is out there that could potentially be giving you a problem. And it's definitely a good place to start, at least to recognize where who some of the big players are.
Can you expand a little bit on Jeff's efforts in terms of, I mean, it seems to me if you're getting into an agreement with somebody, there should naturally be best efforts going on.
You would think, right? Yeah, there
yeah.
should be natural. So we'll take it in the form of trademarks. And so if you have a trademark that you want to license to a company, it's important that if that company is going to use your trademark, that it's going to be on a product that, let's say, you approve of, right? That won't offend anyone. You know that. So that's part of best efforts. That you want to make sure that they're not infringing on your rights or your moral rights, or you know that they're taking the time to market it correctly. Because they have your brand in your hands, right? Because we're talking about trademarks. So you want to make sure that their message is getting across the right way. And so if it's not. By having a best efforts clause, you would have some remedy there, you know. If they're going to put it like on a sex toy or something, that's something that, you know, if it's not one of your licensed products, that would be a violation of best efforts.
Is there more to it than the way they're using it?
Yeah, there's a lot more to it. There just should be, you know, lawyers have to act in certain good faith, right? Good faith efforts. So. There's a, you know, we're talking about like if there's a renewal period, let's say, I'll give an example. If there's a renewal period and 3 months before the renewal period, the licensee is supposed to produce their statement for the year and they don't. And so they produce it maybe one day before the license period is up. That's not really best efforts, right? That's kind of bad faith, right? You agreed that there would be some good faith negotiation at the end of the term. How can we possibly do a negotiation when we only have one day to review what you've done over the last year with our product? That's kind of best efforts. If it's not in there, yes, it's assumed, but it's much better for it to be in there. Don't let them give you that answer. Well, of course we're going to use best efforts, but when they don't, you at least have it in there, you know? Yes, right.
Why would you even use that term, best efforts? Because it just sounds like a, you know, an invitation to court. You know?
Yeah, it's actually, we actually don't use best efforts. We actually use reasonable efforts. But
why not just a date?
There are dates in there, right? But I'm talking about like reasonable commercial best efforts. For instance, if your product was to distribute the product in Europe within 3 days, get it on the shelves, right? So they take it from you 3 days later, they put it on the shelves. And they were supposed to use that 3 days is the reasonable commercial standard, and they're taking 7 days every period. That's not reasonable commercial best efforts, right? Yes, you're right. It's open to interpretation, and it's potential lawsuit, but better it be in there than not.
And I think something else with terms that could be viewed as amorphous, you know, just really loosey-goosey, I feel, and I'm not an attorney, but that it's always good to have other terms that are more significant that might be the benchmark, i.e. reasonable efforts to get it to market. Well, that could almost mean nothing if there was a specific about the sales volume they must achieve.
Right, yeah.
If they achieve that sales volume, I don't give a crap about
right.
it.
Oh, exactly. Yeah.
At some point, though, there's got to be some hard metrics to judge performance by. Just one thing I'd like to mention to everybody, that one thing that shocked me, that a year into this wayward licensing agreement, we were debating whether the agreement was licensing a product or the technology.
Oh, yeah. So a few slides before, application or field or use for the IP. Like, this should be like a no-brainer, right? It should be you are licensing this particular trademark on shoes, or this particular I'm trying to think of a patent example. It should just be descriptive, right? It should be descriptive of the actual patented technology, patent number, patent application number, exactly how the licensee is going to be applying it. It's what we call licensed products, right? It should be very specific. What was the confusion between a technology or what?
Either the underlying technology or the specific product that I had designed.
Yeah. So
that if they were licensing the technology,
they can do anything with it.
Do anything with it.
Create products that, you know, may or may not diminish the value of the brand.
Precisely.
Yeah, core and non-core technology. Huge, right? I mean, if this is where it comes back to the claims, right? If they're reading your spec and they see something that they like and you don't have it claimed, what are they exactly patenting? What are they exactly licensing?
Yeah,
what did you really get the patent on, you know? It has to be specific. It has to be laid out. So it's almost like a no-brainer, but it's not. Yes.
Yeah, great question. Somebody told me, an engineer company, that he has licensed over 100 products. He said that contracts are better, like, say, 15 years ago, where they give you a little, like the age of it is a little different now. But they were better, like, 15 years ago, that you give maybe some money up front.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yeah, I mean, Bruce can probably talk about it more, since I'm only 15, but
you
know,
I mean, you're 20 years ago, whenever.
Yeah, that was a joke. I was only 15. it used to be much easier to license things, right? It used to be much easier. It's just, I think, the product of the world we live in, right? You look at crowdfunding, and I hate to bring that up, and there's so many products there that are licensable, that are not even covered by IP, that they can choose from, right? And so here you are with possibly patenting technology, and there's a lot of companies that don't want to take risks anymore, right? They don't want to give upfront payments unless they've seen you have sales, right? And you have a customer base, and it's changed. It's changed a lot.
So it's like a tough forever for the inventor, right?
Oh,
now?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
And then, okay, two other questions. Number one is, now you want to call up all these people for licensing. They take a call from you. It's like, yeah, who are you? You know what I mean? Like, how do you develop? You had mentioned trade shows.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say this. Listen, I hate to say that it's which law firm you go with, but there is some truth to that, right? There is some truth as to what products or what technologies the law firm has experience with, and whether they're willing, whether your lawyer is going to be your champion and cross-sell and cross-market and cross-promote you to their other clients, right, who are potentially your licensees, right?
Could you speak to that, or maybe even Louis?
Yeah, if we can both speak to it, I think it's important.
If somebody goes to a firm
And you mentioned about Johnson & Johnson.
Yeah.
And law firms, and I've referred people to lawyers a lot, and the lawyer will say, we have to do a conflict check.
Right.
Who is the firm representing?
Right.
If they do have a client who potentially could be a licensee, and how do they set themselves in the right light to make sure that there isn't conflict?
Yeah. Well, Lewis, if you want to talk about it, I'm going to also just give a brief answer. So I have a lot of clients that we cross promoted to other departments in our firms, i.e., other clients to our firms. But it is a very thin line. Like, you can't be your salesman, right? When you're a lawyer, right? The firm cannot necessarily gain some type of monetary interest in the deal, right? We're just really introducing two people, and you take it from there. That's really what it is. And maybe we'll be part of the negotiation of the license, but there's some gray areas in terms of conflict of interest and stuff. Obviously, if we have represented somebody, if we have gone against somebody, and that's your potential licensee, well, we're not going to help you then, right? If this is someone that we've maybe brought a lawsuit against or something like that, so we're not going to help you. But if it's someone that potentially is a licensee, then yeah, there is an opportunity for us to introduce you to someone. But it's going to be, it's going to come down to the product. And you,
some of those, I shouldn't be calling up these places. I should hire a law firm or a broker or something like that.
There is some,
not necessarily.
Yeah,
not necessarily.
It depends. Like, so you can have success doing it on your own. There's plenty
right,
of companies
right, right.
that want to talk to lawyers, right? They want to talk to the inventor. But
a trade show, like you said,
there's likely very little lawyers walking around the trade show shopping licenses.
And then the last question to this, I had a three-part question was, now can you work and deal with these people to where you could have involvement in it? For example, like say you have a series of products that you're coming out with, or you know that you're an author and you want to brand yourself, your books or whatever. Do they let you get involvement in the whole life? Is that ever possible, or they just take it off your hands and say, see you later?
You mean if the law firm gets involved?
The licensee gets involved. The short answer is, it depends.
Yeah.
And it really is, what do you bring to the table? Do you have a reputation? Are you both a personality and an inventor?
Right.
And that could be part of where your rate may be worth 7% instead of 2%. Because they see that there's a built-in following. If you're Martha Stewart, you're licensing your name, she's out there building her brand constantly. So a deal with her is worth very different than some woman who maybe just invented some kitchen products.
But if you are my client and I'm representing you in a license agreement, I mean, everything is going to be run by you, right? Everything is, every one of those terms is going to be run by you.
No, what Bruce said is, say you had the Martha Stewart. Now, say that person wants to become a Martha Stewart and wants to brand themselves, they would take, say, for example, all right, I'll take 1%, just kind of put me out there type of thing. You know what I mean?
Well,
that eventually brand yourself.
It depends.
Yeah.
It really, what do you bring to the table? Is it that you just have a great new kind of cookware? Or do they see that, wow, you write a great blog, so they'd love for you to continue to blog like crazy about your new cookware? There's that whole balance as to what the licensing agreement is about, the scope.
Okay.
To Rick's point, is it the technology? Is it the brand? Is it your name? Is it just a patent number?
Everyone's unique.
I want to go to Lewis just to give his perspective on it.
Representing a small inventor and introducing them to an existing large client, it's going to depend on the size, right? Because if I go to Johnson & Johnson, I know they have other lawyers, so I don't need to be part of the deal. I can go, I can make the introductions, I've got to walk away at a certain point and say, look, or else Johnson & Johnson has to understand that at this particular instance, I'm on the other side of the deal. And some large companies understand that. If you start getting to smaller and smaller companies that you're dealing with, if they're a client and you're a client, it gets to be a stickier wicket. We can take some interest in the product because we usually can't tell. We're not banks, right? We're law firms. So some people are like, well, could you do all this legal work for us? You can get involved. I'll give you a cut of this. And to a certain extent, I have a decent nose for what may work and what may not work, but I still don't. If I could make that kind of money, I wouldn't be your lawyer. I'd be home, right? So it's all hit and miss. And to get your lawyer involved and who to call and who to represent and how much I'm going to get and at what stage, part of it's business. Part of it, you need to lay out the pieces of the puzzle. You need to go home and say, okay, I've talked to a lawyer, these are the pieces of the puzzle. Let me think it through. And then go back and talk again. I do a lot more talking sometimes with my clients than I do actually preparing a piece of paper that says anything. Because I've been with large clients, Dave's been with large clients, we know what they're looking for. We've been on both sides of the deal. So I'll tell you that, look, this clause, you may want it in, but they're going to fight like hell to keep it out. So use that as a negotiating tool for the one you want. So let's talk about the other clause that you're really going to want that you can trade off on. And that's sort of, you don't know that going in. We know what they're supposed to look like. So even if you don't want to use me for the deal, you don't want me to spend 10 hours negotiating with the other side's attorney, fine. But spend an hour with an attorney and spend that money to learn which ones you should really care about. And let us help you craft the business around your IP. And then you can go on your merry way. There are a lot of people in this room who are very smart at what they do for their job. They may be negotiating contracts for a job. I'm sometimes a lawyer's lawyer, you know, and okay, fine. But I have to tell them, look, this is what you got to take care of. This is the piece you got to focus on, and then go have at it. You know, no one in this room is going to say that you are unable or incapable of negotiating a deal, but you haven't done 1,000 of them, right? So you don't know what to look for. And what you think may be, oh my God, I really got it. This is what I got to worry about. That's the red herring. And until you see how they play out, and Dave tells you stories, and I'll tell you stories, and it's like you're getting stories here from real people on how these licenses affect their lives, you don't understand the give and the take. It's not a pitch for you to have a lawyer on every deal you do, but you should talk to one. And we'll tell you, this is what it will cost. This is what it won't cost. This is what it means if it goes wrong. I have plenty of clients that they get into the patenting game, I don't want a European patent. 3 years later, they're in a bloodbath with a French company begging me to do something. And I'm like, sorry. You know, we had this talk 3 years ago. Business-wise, it made sense not to be in France. Today it is, and I can't help you. Sorry. I can call guys in France and figure out a different way, and we're doing that. But you can't have a crystal ball every time. And sometimes you got to say, okay, this is what I got to do. This is where I got to cut my losses. And I got to make the decision today for what's going to happen later. And to Rick's point, for any agreement you're going to get into, I tell people, if you're going to shake somebody's hand and you got to count your fingers when you put your hand back, don't do the deal. The paper is the deal, and the people behind it.
Well said. Lewis mentioned something about international. How much of this actually changes if you're looking to license things overseas?
Well, one, if you're looking to license your patent overseas, you better have a patent overseas, right? I mean, it's like Lewis said, if you don't, or if you're going to get involved with a licensee that is based overseas, you know, you want to, they're likely
filing
not...
them very early, too, because
yeah.
You have to know that. There's what's the cutoff on when you have to file them?
So if you had a provisional, it's 1 year from the provisional, right? That same time you have to file your non-provisional is when you have to file your PCT. You have a utility, not you don't have a provision, you have a utility, and it's 1 year. It's always 1 year. We just remember that 1 year. And a lot of countries, the license agreement, when you sign that license agreement with a particular country, like let's say in Europe, and maybe Jesus can, and I'll introduce Jesus in a minute. A lot of countries record those license agreements, right? So they have record of what IP is being licensed and who the parties are and stuff like that. So it doesn't just fall into obscurity somewhere.
And if you're thinking about international, sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't even say quadruple, you know, 5 times, 6 times, whatever your IP budget is for what you're doing in the U.S. alone, you're going to need 6 times that, at least for offshore.
Yeah.
It's going to be deep into the six, well, I shouldn't say deep, well into the six figures.
It's expensive.
For
the PCT up front is, you know, one time fee, what, $4,000 or $5,000, right? But then 30 months later, when you have to actually take that into all the different countries that you want, to one of those countries, you know, what is it, $5,000-$6,000 per country, and that's just to start the examination process, right?
It's a business consideration.
Yeah, but
think
yeah.
About that.
But hopefully by then, that would have been 3 years, right?
Yeah.
So hopefully there's
no, it's
some...
not 3 years. It's if you wait 1 year from the provisional.
No, I'm talking about when you have to choose. When you have to choose the countries, you're going to file your PCT, right? And then you're going to have 30 months from the time you file your PCT. 30 months, it's 2.5 years. So it'll be 3.5 years from the time you filed, or 4.5 years from the time, 3.5 years from the time you filed your provisional. Hopefully there would have been some traction already with the patent, with the US side. Hopefully you've gotten your US patent by then. And hopefully you have identified some potential licensees in these different countries. If you have a European, if you have someone in Europe or China, then from the PCT, when you go national at 30 months, you choose China, you choose Europe. You don't choose Africa if you're not going to be doing business in Africa.
The best advice that Dave is getting through and that I get to the client is the day you need to start your licensing thought isn't the day after you file your provisional or the day after you file your utility. They should all happen at once. You need to do all of your homework. You need to hit the ground running. A year is a very short window for the amount of money you need to spend to figure it out.
Yeah.
And you need to be, when I say pull the trigger, you need to have your list, you need to have your business plan, you need to have your slides, you need to have your elevator pitch, you file and fire. 6 months into it, if you still haven't figured out who you need to talk to, you're either going to lose it on an uneducated decision, or you're going to spend a lot of money needlessly. Maybe not, maybe so. It's all about knowledge. It's all about knowing that you've made a decision to say, at the time, I don't have the 10 grand to go to Europe, and I'm going to live with that, so I'm going to focus my effort on U.S. companies. Or, guess what? My largest market isn't the U.S. market, so I really need to be talking to somebody overseas, because the U.S. is not where I'm doing my sales. It's Great Britain. It's France. It's Russia. It doesn't matter, but you need to know that. Sometimes even before you come see me, or Dave, or Bill, because... we can guide you, but to pay us to write the map for you is not worth your time or money. You want to have everything laid out and then ask us to help craft it for you. That's the best use of your money.
Yeah, agree.
In other words, it's the golden age of the license agreement. So would that tend to be more beneficial to starting your own company around your business? Or that's even, that golden age is kind of behind us as well.
No, well, I hope not.
Is that more of an initiative, just taking your own way 100%? That's what I'm saying. That's what I meant.
The golden answer is it depends.
Yeah.
It really does.
JD, when you were in Germany.
Thank you.
I want to introduce Jesus. Can you introduce yourself? And it's a real treat to have you in the audience.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jesus. Yeah.
It's okay, it's only one.
Thanks, David, for letting me introduce. I come from Spain. I'm here, in fact, since 2 weeks in New York. I work for the European Patent Office. I've been patent examiner, and then I've been working for years in the harmonization of the patent system between patent offices in the US, China, and Europe, Korea as well. I know well how the patent system works, and I think it's very interesting to hear what you said, the questions that you ask, because it's exactly the same questions that we get in Europe, also in China, when we talk to inventors and companies. So the problems that you have, they're really everywhere. The patent system is not easy, and this is what I know. Obviously, outside of the patent system, you have what David is explaining about monetization of patents and licensing. This is not what we do in the patent offices. But as I say, the patent system as such is really complex, and what comes afterwards is also very complex. And I've always, I never like very much this answer, it depends, but it's the best answer that
thank you.
We can give. No, but it's also true when people come to me asking for advice, how does the system work in the patent office, what should I do, what shouldn't I do, it really depends. And getting professional advice is probably very useful. Often you have to do your homework, I fully agree. But at some stage, things become serious, getting the advice of people who have done the same many times, and then give advice on your specific situation is probably a good idea. That's
Bill, did you want to say anything?
Dave is drinking a little here.
I think you guys have.
No?
Jenny, you had a question?
No, because I think you have a unique perspective and then you, and then you represent startups and entrepreneurs.
Yeah. Well, I can say that most people that come into my office have not done their homework. So I kind of explained to them the ABCs of what we've all been discussing here, and not tell them go do that and come back, but I try to help walk them through it a little bit. So I can speak to the difficulty of doing it all at the same time, but if you're not doing your homework, you are kind of flushing money down the toilet. Your patent is not going to be very good, you know. If you don't really pay attention to what your technology does and explain it to your patent attorney and really like get the down to the nitty gritty of it, and I find some clients just want that process over with so they can go make money on it. That's really going to, submarine your entire future with the technology to begin with. It's a hard thing, you know. You can have the best idea in the world, and, people talk about how do we get companies who want to license it or buy it from us. Well, you know, a lot of the best ideas in the world have just gone by the wayside. It happens. I think it's just about perseverance, networking, and working with your lawyers and other folks in your network to get it out there.
Thanks, yeah.
Thank you. Jenny had a question. She's been patient.
Hi, I have a design patent in the UK and the EU. I'm waiting on my patent for the US. But I didn't go through China because I was told that there's more infringement there than anywhere else.
No.
Is that a good advice? Is it worth getting a patent, a design patent in China?
What we see, at least from the figures we have in the European people, is the number of patents in China is increasing very rapidly. And there's more and more efforts put by the Chinese government to enforce the patent system and to make it stronger. So many more companies are now going and filing patents in China. So I think the situation is changing very rapidly. That's my feeling. So it might be worth considering, but probably you have more experience.
Something I tell people a lot is, regardless of, let's pick on China right now since you asked about that. If you have no intention or think you're never going to be marketing your product in China, it may not be worth the investment, okay? Because the infringement, while it may be being built in China, it's still coming into the U.S., and you can exert your rights here in the U.S. no matter where it's produced. So I think you have to think about where you're marketing, where you're selling, where you're producing. And do you have an ability to have a choke point? And usually, can't say this with 100% certainty, the person that's hurting you with the infringement based upon somebody you think is making it in China, the most important infringer is that U.S. dirtbag who is importing it, because he saw it in the market as successful, and he's the one that took the product and said to a Chinese factory, please knock this off. Okay, so you can't necessarily paint this broad brush about Chinese infringers. It's somebody who's very opportunistic here. So once again, if you are only marketing here, might not be worth the investment in and distraction and taking all those resources away.
You know,
so.
We were talking earlier, a lot of people are, kind of one-shot ponies. They have one patent and they're looking to make money on just that one patent. It's important that you become much more attractive if you have a portfolio of stuff, right? If you have your trademark or if you have a design patent along with it, or if you have a whole other invention, right? You will. I can't remember who we were talking about, Gordon. We were talking about it earlier today. That if you have if you are a serial inventor and you have multiple patents, likely a company that's going to be licensing from you might see some potential for future licenses, other licenses. So if you want to just be one of, if you just want to have one, if you want to just invent and concentrate on one, know that that's just a much more that's a harder opportunity to realize when it's just when you're putting all your eggs in one basket. Even if that means following continuation or continuation in part, even if it means improving your own patent, just try to get a portfolio, right? And try to get some type of just more than one. Yeah.
As far as going to a trade show and approaching someone with something that's patent pending, what is to stop someone from, you know, let's say it's not granted, but you're approaching them for some kind of licensing agreement. How do you sort of navigate that?
Well, for sure you want an NDA, right? But it depends if it's published already and it's public knowledge. Then there's really nothing you can do in terms of them accessing it or not, right? They're going to find it out whether you tell them about it or not, right? So you just have to trust in the system at that point, right? And as you know, you can only bring a patent infringement suit based on a patent, right? So if your application never becomes a patent, then there's really nothing to talk about, right? So I guess what I'm trying to say is don't, it's okay, talk. I mean, somebody just said this the other day, I can't remember who it was, but it was perfect. It was at another meetup. If you're going to tell somebody your idea, and we probably have said it in here a few times, likely they will not have the passion that you have, right? And so I really believe in that, right? And so if that can cut down some of the barriers and you don't have to be so protective about your stuff, your ideas, please do that. But again, if we're talking about a provisional and it's really in the infancy stage, I would like to get an NDA, sign a non-disclosure.
When you take out a booth at a show, you're kind of patent pending. Everyone's going to come and look at your product.
The
difference is you're marketing it yourself.
Yeah.
You're relying upon the commercial success of your product based upon your complete efforts. Somebody else approaching you will want to potentially license it based upon seeing that it's an extension of your business and it's in a segment that they're not in. So, hate to use it again, it depends. You know, if you are commercially implementing your own IP, you're building equity yourself. And so if you happen to find some potential licensee, great. Otherwise, you're still, hopefully, you're not investing in a trade show booth just to maybe meet a licensee or not. So you have to balance that.
Yeah, I have a client who's going to be at a, she's going to be launching her product publicly for the first time in May. And we're going to be filing a design patent and a utility patent prior to May, but that's really, I mean, that's the really only peace of mind I can offer her if she's going to go public with it, right? If she's going to put it on display to the world. But, I mean, I think it's just to go back to what Bruce said. I don't know. Even though I don't trust anybody, I do tend to see the good in people, and so I hope if you're going to have a booth and you're going to be inside the industry, and that this is an industry you want to be a part of, that they're not going to screw you, right? If this is the industry that you want to be a part of.
Well, I just know from going through the Jeff's and the gift show, you see like one year, somebody's got this product, and next year. Yeah.
Well, okay, so perfect example, 3D printing, right? Used to be, I went to the Maker Fair 2 years ago, and there was one 3D printer booth. This year there was like 40. And I was like, what's going on over here? What's happening here? Like, why is everyone infringing everybody, right? The only thing I can say to that is that 3D systems, the grandfather of 3D printing, I'm just hoping they're lying in wait, right? Waiting for these 40 MFs to do really well and come after them, right?
Is that a legal term?
Yeah. So I'm hoping they're just lying in wait and hopefully they're gonna pounce. But would I recommend you to do that? No, like I wouldn't. Would I recommend you to do a patent search, file an application, and draft something that goes around 3D systems and then publicly display it? Yes. Did they do that? No. Yeah.
Can you touch a little bit on patenting software? Because you can't patent a math equation, which is essentially what coding is. So how does one go and patent something like an app or
program?
So business methods, software patents, Supreme Court, right? Big, you know, sometimes they are patentable, sometimes they are patentable. The current state of affairs is that they are patentable. It can't be an abstract idea, right? It can't be like, you can't have a math equation for 2 + 2, right? Because you can do that in your head. So as long as you have some type of business method that's tied to some type of computer system, i.e. software, then you should be okay as long as the method that you are trying to patent is not already taken, right? That somebody else has not already done it. Most of my clients are software developers and app developers and stuff like that. So in my world, it is very lucrative and it is patentable, but it's the same processes, right? You just gotta make sure that you patent cleared it, file your application, and you make sure that you're not infringing anyone. Are you not feeling that? Are you feeling that?
Well, mine is really simple. Like, I already went through all this with another attorney, but I actually guide people in building apps and stuff like that, and I have a long thing about it. Bruce, I interviewed Bruce for a book that I wrote about taking an idea and making it reality using apps and stuff like that. And my IP lawyer at the time, and I only used him because he was the only one that I knew when he was relatively cheap.
It's a great reason.
Well, I called him.
That was before you came to this.
That was before I came back. Yeah. It was a bad networking group. This is a good networking group. But no, we ran into problems with prior art and stuff like that because there was a patent front. My app is called SimuPad. It's a PDF signature application.
Right.
Shameless self-plug. There was prior art. There's prior art from 1987 where somebody goes, if I fax this document, it can come up on a mobile telephone screen and you can sign it on a mobile. Obviously, not at all the same as.
Right. Technology has improved.
Right. And we still got denied because of that.
Right.
And I never followed up on it. I didn't want to put any more money into it and stuff like that. So it started off with, can we patent the code? No. Can we patent a portion of the app? Can we patent just like the special features that make the app what it is, and like it just became like a, I just didn't want to bother.
Yeah,
I didn't really care because I know in like 3 years the iPad's not going
to
really be
so
what it is anyway.
So I think the point is, if I could boil it down, is to what extent is software patentable?
Yeah, and that's
are there any broad strokes in my
well, so that so that's really down to the Supreme Court. I mean, 10 years ago, if you asked that question, it would be different, and now it's currently in front of the Supreme Court, CLS versus Alice, huge case that. Possibly could be the end of a lot of software patents if it's if they agree with the lower court. I have drafted a 200-page software application, and the claim focused on one little algorithm, one little search type of it was a search matching. Method. I mean, that's not what he came in to patent, right? I mean, he came in to patent this entire app, but it just didn't work out like that. So right now, it is patentable if you can tie it to a system. So I'm not sure why it was denied. And
we're gonna talk about it.
Yeah, and you know why you gave up. I probably wouldn't have given up that easily.
But I would say it's a general.
It depends.
Well, no. Is there a business strategy behind it?
Right.
Investing the money in filing that patent, and then prosecuting the patent, and hopefully getting issued.
Right.
Is there a business strategy that warrants the investment?
Yeah. You know, app developers. Listen, if it's an app, it's a flash in the pan. I don't know if it's going to wait 3 years to get your patent to enforce it. No. But if it's something that you're going to rely your entire business on, and it's something that's long-lasting, there's plenty of apps like that, then yeah. You know, we represent a large lighting company. They're finally going to do this mobile app that they're going to offer to some of their clients. They are going to invest in a patent application. They're not going to charge their clients for it. It's going to be a free app for them, but they want the ability to at least own the technology on it. But it's going to be part of their structure probably for the next 15, 20 years. So. You know, Uber is a kind of great example of an app that you know might have some legs, right? That might actually last a few years, but Yeah, so it depends on the product, and it depends on, you know, we've had some apps in here,
mm-hmm,
right,
right,
that have done some pitches and stuff like that, and some of them have legs, right, so some of them can really stand the time, and, you know, their entire business structure is based on the app, right, that is their front and back house, you know, yeah.
Yes, sir. Another question.
Last line on your slide there. A little just more detail. Higher than investment to get the market to lower the rate, no debt.
Yeah, it's kind of what we were talking about before. That if a licensee is going to spend a lot of money to
get the rate they invest.
Yeah.
In production.
Yeah. I was talking from the other end.
Licensee.
Yeah. Here. So yeah, we kind of talked a lot of this. So each deal is unique. Royalty rates. Here's some kind of general rates that you could expect out of consumer products and software. Well, I'm going to move on from this, actually. this kind of goes to what you were talking about. A lot of licensing companies will send you a memorandum of understanding, right? So maybe an email saying, oh, we'll give you, you know, 10%, $50,000 up front. And the term will be for 3 years, and that's not what's enforceable, right? You need to make sure that is memorialized into an agreement. You'd be surprised how many people have allowed the rights to their patent or trademark based on a non-legal document, like based on an email or based on a term sheet or something. I mean, what? I mean, so don't do that. Like, you should have a signed agreement, signed by both parties, and negotiated. Through and through. So some of the pitfalls, you know, not consulting a lawyer, not reading, you know, that's important. You'd be surprised, always try to leave yourself a back door, make sure you have a way to get out of it, due diligence. Let's talk about
Excuse me, if I could, just about the thing, not using a lawyer, some people I've encountered don't use a lawyer, and they say, well, my friend had a licensing agreement, and he gave me his agreement, and he... Like,
oh my God! Yeah,
a cut and paste,
yeah.
And like so immediately, it's like lawyer by osmosis.
Yeah,
doesn't work that way.
Yeah,
every deal is different.
Yeah, and this is also, if any of you have websites, oh my God, please do not take like Google's terms of service and put it on your terms of service. Like, that is so bad. Like and I was gonna say other things and name other companies, but let me not do that.
What's back door?
So leave yourself a way to get out of it. Like, make sure that there's some way that you can possibly exit without having to pay attorney fees or
and is there any, say you have a contract that's not a legal contract or something, and then the person kind of beat you for money, is there a legal recourse with that, even if it's not an official document or emails or something?
A civil action, right? You can bring a civil action and hope that your evidence stands up, right? Hope you can discover all the emails and whatnot. So it's a long process. You don't want to potentially. But that actually brings up a good point. So a license agreement. If you breach a license agreement, there could be two causes of action there, right? There could be the breach of the actual IP, right? If they're maybe somehow infringing your rights to the IP, and if they are legally breaching the terms of the agreement. If you don't sign a lease. And you and your landlord have a dispute, and you have a much stronger case if you had a lease, right? You sign a lease with them.
Did you say what MOU was?
A memorandum of understanding, like a term sheet. Sometimes they have these, you know, it's like these, you know, fill in the, like, it's like a pre-printed sheet, and the, you know, they'll do like royalty rate 5%, and you know, upfront payment, they fill in 50%. It's like their internal version of a form that they use and they send to you. But that's not legal in any way. You should get a negotiated license agreement. So other ways to, it's not all about licensing, right? There are other things you can do, right? And a lot of what's going to happen now. A lot of it hinges on whether you have a patent, right? Or whether you have a trademark, you have a registration, right? And sir?
On that, I don't want to own a business, but I'm also thinking maybe I should just, after I do a search with a lawyer or not, maybe I should just do a trademark.
You know that?
Does a trademark hold up as prior art as well as provisional?
So funny because my mom doesn't know what I do for a living, right? My mom. I mean, she. I'm sorry. She knows what I do for a living. She doesn't understand what I do for a living. So she will sometimes say to me, "David, I saw this great product in Walmart. Do you think they have a trademark on it?" And I'll be like, "No, Ma. It's probably a patent, right? The trademark is the brand, right?" So, or my little sister will say, "Can I patent that trademark?" No. So a patent, trademark, copyright, three separate things, right? So trademark is the brand, patent is the invention, the process, the method, the way you're doing business. The trademark is the brand representation of that product.
That's a lesson short.
Yeah.
Lesson short. If I go and potential licensing with a trademark,
right,
that represents a product as a brand, it's similar to what they're doing or whatever. Does that hold weight?
Ah, I see what you're saying. Ooh, I don't know about that. So this is a successful company that already likely has a patent on the product or not. Is selling their product by a certain brand, and you've now created another brand that you want to license to them?
Well, whether they, I'm just trademark. I didn't think it through in terms of conflict with their brand.
Right.
But
David, if I may, why don't we take that towards the end, maybe at the.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of prior art.
Prior art and trademarks, two different, you know, prior art goes to patents, right? That doesn't have a trademark.
Trademark cannot be a prior art.
Correct. That's not even, that's two, they don't even meet in the same, they're not even in the same realm. Prior art is a patent term.
Okay, but if you have, if you're trademarking something, that something is prior art. But you're saying trademark doesn't cover it.
No.
In terms of.
No.
Trademarks just.
That's what
you're
talking about.
Yeah. Well, we'll have time for questions at the end also, and that might be better as
questions. Yeah, I don't understand the question.
So.
Yeah, we'll come back to that, I guess. Yeah, we'll come back to that. Yeah.
Hypothetically, if you, I mean, suppose you don't want a trademark, you just want a patent, and then you want to license that out, and that's obviously doable, and the company, I guess, can make the trademark, or, and that's the other thing, would you get in the whole licensing deal, of both trademark and a patent, you're probably more likely to get more percentage.
Right, if you have both,
If you have both.
Correct,
But what about they want to say, hey, I want to go with the patent, but not the trademark, they could say that too. Like,
technically,
yeah.
They could also license your trademark and not use it, right? They could be part of the deal if they're just trying to make you go away, right? So they could even buy it outright from you and make it go away. Licensing.
They just have to use it in the future, or maybe they use it in a person.
Right. It depends. Yeah. With trademarks, it's much harder. Trademarks. Your brand has to be recognizable for a company to even pay notice to you. Right. It's less likely. You have to have some market pull already. You have to have a customer base. As opposed to a patent. I mean, yes, we're saying you do, but there are situations where. You don't necessarily have to have sold anything if the company believes in the patent and maybe wants to get involved, maybe they're licensing the trademark, because of the whole brand aspect of it should have some weight already, there are defensive ways to do it. There are, like for instance, Google buys up a lot of similar marks to Google to make them go away if they actually get through the process, they make them go away. Yes, sorry, yeah.
You have a slide that that shows the financial calculations to arrive at the value of your product in terms of what you might ask for up front. Okay.
It depends what the product is, right?
I know, but you have something that shows how to do that. In terms of, if you can estimate what the sales might be, okay, on a series of years, how you bring that forward and how you present it and package that number.
So I don't have a slide on it, but I do have a slide that's coming up on what we in the industry are called valuation services. These are companies that you can go to, and they can assess your product, assess your competitors, assess your claims, assess your market, assess the price per unit, assess how much it's going to make. But just last month, we had somebody here talking about how you can do that, right? These are things that you can do with the ACE number. whoever was here last month, there is a tool that the Department of Commerce has called the ACE tool. Can't remember what it stands for. Assess costs everywhere. Like how much it would cost to produce in China or have labor in Singapore. Because really you should be going into those meetings with some idea of how much it's going to cost to make your product, produce your product, manufacture your product. Yeah. But there are calculations, but it really depends on the product.
You said it twice in the past 2 minutes.
I know, but I don't want to say it depends. I'm trying to change it up a little bit. Patent brokers, right? These are people that will, if you have a patent, they will take a percentage. Sometimes some of them work on contingencies. Some of them work on commissions. They are looking to find you the best deal for your patent. This is not going to make you $1 million. I don't know how else to say it. Right? They're going to take a large chunk of how much you're going to get. Right? So I'm just putting it out there because if you're just fed up with the whole thing and you just don't want to deal with it anymore, you might think about giving your patent over to a patent broker. Let them shop it for you. It's kind of like your own personal headhunter. Yeah, exactly. Edison is an entirely different thing. That's licensing. This is outright selling, right? This is like having no ownership anymore, like selling your patent to somebody so somebody can shop that for you. They're called patent brokers. Think about it. You should definitely look into it. But I chose this picture for a reason, right? Because they're patent brokers. And they're not the first up in the slides, but you know the last choice that I think I would counsel a client for. I mean, you should be involved in your patent and in the industry and in the selling and the future of your patent. So if you're giving up and giving it over to a patent broker, it's not going to be a good deal for you at the end of the day. Because again, that last thing makes you the least. You're not going to get a lot of money for it.
But David,
they're taking all the risk.
Is there really a big difference here between selling it and outright assigning it?
Yeah, well, selling 100% of your ownership, that's it done.
But assigning
you know?
Is the same thing. If it's a permanent assignment, isn't that the same thing?
Well, assigning and licensing are two different things, as is outright selling, right? Licensing is you're going to get a royalty rate from it.
That.
Assigning is just assigning a particular right. So there's no royalty or anything like that.
Permanent assignment. You have no way of getting that back.
So it sounds like you're selling 100% ownership in it.
It sounds like.
But if you assigned it, there is some control that you are retaining over it. You know. So you don't have to do 100%, right? You can do 50% or 80%. You can do that as an assignment too, you know? You don't have to give 100% ownership of it. It's also a liability factor, right? I mean, if correct me if I'm wrong here, Lewis, but if you're gonna assign your right to another entity and they're gonna have ownership, there is some liability still as the assignor, right? If I'm not mistaken. There is some, right? So you as the assignor still have some liability attached to it. As opposed to selling 100% of all your ownership interest in it, you're cut from the deal altogether. Kind of right? Right, Lewis?
And you may still
yeah.
be responsible for the maintenance fees.
Right.
There's a slight convolution of terms, but it's
right.
the same thing. An assignment is sort of the end product of the sale.
Right.
Right. You can either, I tell people a patent is like owning a house with a spouse. Okay? You can have multiple people own the property, but it's one piece of property. Like, you get to live in it, your spouse gets to live in it. You can both sell the house, and now nobody lives in it, right? Or one of you can move out, the other one can stay in. The other one decides to rent her room or his room, then you got a roommate because you both own it. So when you say assignment, it's just sort of the end product of
right.
some form of sale.
Okay.
All
right.
Yes.
Is Forky a broker, a patent broker?
I didn't realize the Kirk comes back to haunt me every time I'm up here. Quirky. Quirky is a crowdsourcing, crowdfunding. Quirky is they do not you retain some right to your patent, but they do most of it. Right? They are you are. I think for all intents and purposes, you are assigning most of your ownership in it, and you are, it's been a while, and you are, you definitely reap some benefit from it as opposed to selling your patent outright. Yeah, but they do everything, they pay for everything, they make all the money up front, and you get a small percentage.
Like an author would on the book.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But, you know, again, patent brokers, this is for outright selling, like saying goodbye to it forever, you know? People do it.
The Kickstarter, do they take a percentage? Do you, when you go on Kickstarter, you have to be patented already?
No.
With your product?
So Kickstarter doesn't care if you have a patent, trademark, or copyright. If you read the terms of service, they are just helping you get your campaign out there in terms of crowdfunding. They hold themselves entirely blameless if somebody came along and said, you are infringing my, your product that you have there, you have a patent or not, are infringing my product. They hold themselves entirely blameless, right? So you are completely responsible for that. So they take no interest in it, except they take a portion of the fees that are collected, right? But they don't own any part of your patent if you have come to them with a patent.
Right. What are the people that put money into it get?
So they, it depends, right? They can get a thank you. They can get a t-shirt. But just hopefully in August,
you
right?
Pick
so
the rewards.
Yeah. So come this August, we have equity crowdfunding, right? That's the SEC rules. It makes crowdfunding available to everyone. So in exchange for $10, maybe I get like 1% of your company that you have up there. I mean, that's a totally big general statement. It's going to be much harder, and it's a much harder process to get into. But we probably should do an equity crowdfunding,
yeah,
because it's about to happen. And we spoke about it a year and a half ago, and it's about to go live.
SEC,
SEC has their final rules, and the comment period just ended a few weeks ago. And you can read all the letters and stuff like that people were submitting. And it's about a year and a half late, the rules, but hopefully in August they'll come out. And there's five or six portals that are set to kind of go live with the with when the actual rules go out, and it should be an exciting time because it's going to be a whole nother monetization, which I didn't even include here. It's going to be a whole nother monetization element for you. But again, it's giving away a portion of your company, i.e., if your company owns your IP, then you're giving away a portion of your IP as well.
It'll be a great opportunity, but there'll be no panaceas.
Yeah.
So, but it is. I think it's a good idea to. Are people interested in hearing about equity crowdfunding?
Yeah. But I was a little scared by all the regulations, the auditing and all.
Yeah,
the
that's the
filing.
Well, here's the.
There's still going to be a lot of regulatory issues, hoops to jump through, ways to stay on the good side of it and the wrong side. Know what you're giving away. It can be a hairy mess. It's a great opportunity for people, but at the same time, you're still going to need attorneys, you need accountants, and all that money you might get will be find places to go other than into your product.
The rules are going
to
be different for the non-accredited investors versus the accredited investors.
Correct.
Is doing right now.
Correct. They're all going to be
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm just talking about for a company who is offering equity on a crowdfunding portal. There will be restrictions, requirements,
there's
things to keep you.
There's restrictions, requirements now, but it's going to be different with non-accredited investors.
I'm not talking about who you let in. It's a matter of how you account and report to the people who are your investors.
Okay.
And there are going to be term sheets galore, and there's going to be fraud, and there's going to be great opportunity. It's going to be a little bit of a Wild West for a while. So.
Yeah,
is it a good time to do it now?
So,
I don't want to get into it. We could go on for another hour about crowdfunding.
No, yeah, we're not going to
do a separate presentation on that.
We will do a separate presentation.
Here's the thing. Everything we were talking about, business plans and all that, you're going to need all that for equity. So you should be thinking, like, the things you're going to be thinking about licensing, you should be thinking about that. So you should, yeah.
It's not
yeah.
trivial.
Yeah.
Or a great way. Oh, snap, I think it's always $1 million.
Yeah, it's going to be tough.
Question?
Do they have any idea of how they would wind up doing the valuation for something like that, as far as who gets what percentage, and,
or
like,
this one.
Let's face it, like, if you're doing like crowdfunding, and, you know, maybe it's 20% of maybe everything you've invested, maybe it's 90%, you know, and, you know, how do you decide that, like, once you reach your goal, whatever it is, or if you break through that goal, you know, that's, and you could be giving away a lot of your company and not even wanting to.
Yes.
Yeah. You don't break through those goals. You set the goal, and that's what you get.
Yeah. I mean,
and it stops. This is not like reward-based funding.
I don't want to cut this conversation off because it's a good conversation, but I think if we had a focus on this in the next few months as the SEC rules are defined, because that's been one of the problems, is nobody has known exactly what the SEC is going to require.
Have they disclosed those rules?
They're out.
And Dave referenced someone who I know very well, who is a recognized expert, and we'll have her in and create a panel. I think it'll be a great opportunity. Okay. Lady in the back had a question.
Is there a sample licensing
in the data? There isn't, but I can definitely send you one that's kind of boilerplate.
How will we get this presentation?
Can we send it after? Can we send the presentation?
Can you send me a PDF,
and then
I'll send it out.
Yeah. Real quickly, back to patent brokers. So this was the average price, the median price for a patent sold. It's a good kind of estimate, about $140,000. And you obviously can make more through a license agreement and through having a successful company.
Dave, where did you get that figure?
So this is from the Licensing Executive Society. Anybody familiar with them? Yeah. Besides you, so they're a national based organization made up of licensees, licensors, and they're also not for profit. They're education and empowerment also, and very general numbers. But
what's
the Licensing Executive Society, the LES. Patent brokers, not attorneys, and want you to realize that. But we'll move on from patent brokers. So what a lot of you tend to do and want to do is to do it yourself, right? Market yourself, do everything yourself. But this goes back to that original thing, I think, when we first started. A lot of you are creatives, right? A lot of you are engineers. A lot of you are product designers or what, but you're not businessmen and businesswomen. And that's the hat you're going to have to wear in addition if you're going to be dealing with a lot of these issues. So. I'm not saying it can't be done, but there needs to be some education, because there's a lot of things that you're going to have to. Actually, this is probably what Bruce can help you with. Actually, I'm thinking about these are probably a lot of the issues that he deals with. Like if you're going to have to find your manufacturer overseas, or if you're going to do something in house, meaning the United States. So these are things that if you want to do yourself, you can do yourself. But you are prone to possibly making mistakes, and we don't want that to happen. Patent monetization firms, these are firms that literally will try to monetize your patent for you. So everybody know what a patent troll is? So this has become the new kind of a scary term out there. So there are companies out there and that have recognized that the only way they're going to force another company to take a license from you is to contact that company and show them that they are ready to bring you into court for potential patent infringement or trademark infringement. So by forcing you into court, they are hoping that the other side will say, oh my God, wait, we don't want to go down a $1 million court battle. We will pay you the license that you want. So there are firms, or there are actual firms who do this, who will take on your patent, analyze your claims, who will develop a cease and desist letter or some type of letter, and they'll send it to the big companies or potential licensees and force them into a rock and a hard place. To do this type of work, though, to actually do this analysis of your claims, of your patent, to do the valuation, they take a gross percentage of whatever you're going to do. So with anything, if you're going to use a patent monetization firm and you're going to force your licensee into business with you, the actual net benefit to you will be lower than if you maybe did it amicably. It depends on your claims, it depends on your product, but it's just another opportunity for you, for someone to do the licensing, to force somebody into a license with you. it's not, you know, it's not a pleasant experience by any means, because you are threatening a lawsuit against them. But on the flip side of that, there are, oh, so this is, I put this up there because law firms can help you with this kind of stuff too, right? So we have plenty of clients that come into us and they say, well, you know, so we have a patent and we're looking to monetize it. We think, you know, Google is, we think Google, Yahoo, and all these search engines are infringing us. So a law firm can do that for you too, right? We could analyze your patent and your potential infringers, you know, and threaten a lawsuit, and hopefully they'll decide to come to the table and negotiate a license with you. So just to give you some examples, so to do that whole thing where you go to a law firm sometimes and you ask them to do a patent review of your claims and to possibly force a license out of someone, if you actually bring the lawsuit and you settle, that can cost up to that 6 month period can be $500,000, because you know there's a lot of discovery and there's a lot of records, a lot of time spent, and it's a very expensive process to force someone into court and to actually go through with a patent infringement lawsuit. Nobody really wants to get involved in it, but nobody's gonna be the first one to say that, right? So everybody's gonna try to you know, scare you away. So I'm bringing this up because patent trolls are people that may contact you, right? So we'll go back to this initial thing. So people may contact you as opposed to you contacting them and ask you to be and want to buy your patent from you so they can then enforce it against somebody else, right? So again, likely you're likely going to be X'd out of that deal. They're looking to buy the patent from you and then possibly enforce it to you. I bring this up because as solo inventors, you are the targets of patent trolls, right? So your product, if you have recognized a potential infringer and they're a big mama company, likely they are going to try to force you out of business, right? So hopefully you can be proactive about it and go to a patent monetization firm or go to a law firm and be the first one to bring the suit against a large company, because if you don't, the potential for a company to do it to you is very real. And there are companies that are specifically out there for this purpose. There are companies that don't practice the products that they are buying, right? And they are trying to enforce these patents as a way to monetize them for themselves. So it's a scary world out there. I guess there was always patent trolls, but it's become a real, you know, bane of the small inventor's existence.
So, you know, if the PTO is ever going to change the rules?
So besides the PTO, it's actually gotten to Congress, right? So Congress has now said there are three bills that I think I've just passed into law, if I'm not mistaken, that protect the small inventor from patent troll, where they're trying to say that the non-practicing entity, i.e. the patent troll, i.e. the company that is not making phones but is buying phone patents to enforce, that they have to have that their main thrust, their main core business can't be that, right? It has to be, you know, Motorola buying up this is just a general example, that Motorola has to buy up the phone patent and then enforce it. It can't be like some clothing company and that's buying them, because that's happening, right? There are people who think this is a new way of making money. So it's to protect the small inventor. But the patent office, I don't think, is anything. I don't think they've taken a side either way. I don't think they can take a side either way. Yes.
Sounds like it could hurt the small inventor.
Yeah.
Since you're the biggest targets of the biggest companies, so it sounds like patent trolls could help small inventors, you know, even the playing field.
I hope. Yeah, I hope. It hasn't worked out like that, but I hope. Yes, right. The biggest targets are like Google and AT&T. They're the ones that are getting hit with patent suits, but
it's a mixed discussion.
Yeah.
And the term patent troll is a bit pejorative because I'm a non-practicing entity. There are many non-practicing entities
right
in the room. You know, somebody who patents who has not yet implemented is a non-practicing entity.
Right.
So, and a lot of the legislation is being driven by those people
right
up there, Google, AT&T, Apple, Samsung.
With lobbyists.
People at the lobbies, exactly. So be careful of the term patent troll, because some of it is done in a way that is beneficial to people who own patents, and some of it is people who are exploitive as a business model.
But just to give an idea, I mean, for 3,608 suits in 2013, that's unheard of. Those are by patent trolls or non-practicing entities, as we say. Lewis, did you want to wrap RPX? Because this is also a new, I think the company's been around since 2004. Yeah, please talk about them, because it's definitely an option.
So the thing for non-practicing entities and these firms that are aggregators, they call them aggregators, right? So patent aggregators. The nice thing about them is that they've actually created a market. Before they came on the scene about 10, 12 years ago, there wasn't an open market to value a patent, right? So because they've gotten into the market, there were these lawsuits, there are entities who don't make or sell and just enforce or license. There's now a value. There's actually a trading floor. You can get your patents openly traded like on a market. There's auction floors for it. The flip side is where does the small inventor fit in with that? And you can fall on either side of the fence. You could fall toward the, hey, we want to buy your patent so we can beat somebody over the head with it. Or there's the aggregator side, which is, hey, we'd like to buy your patent so we can use it as a shield. So everybody in our aggregation pool it now is licensed to it, and you can't no longer use this as a sword because everybody who's taken a piece of our aggregation pool is licensed to it. When you enter pools like that, on either side, there's a buy version of it, there's a license version of it. There are pieces of it, but it's the asset. And when they say it depends on the asset. What do you have and how important it is to the industry? You know, we've taken on single clients, and because he invented a little piece of secret sauce for LEDs, and there's a number of large people that we can beat over the head with it. Another guy, and I invented, of all things, it's a specialized winch for curtain. Okay? It's how you get the curtain up and down, and lights across the stage, and all this other stuff. So they're very specialized targets, but they're expensive pieces of machinery, there's only a few targets, and so there make some money viable. Other clients go to the aggregators, or they sell to the aggregators, they buy from an aggregator. Because they've opened the market, there's money there, right? You gotta know how to find it. You have to know who to talk to. You have to know what you wanna do. What is the asset in your hand? Is it your baby? Most of these people are gonna say, this is my baby, I've never sold my baby. And other people say, you know what? I know what this
right
is.
Price.
At the right price,
yeah.
I can be bought. Even my children will be bought. And so you got to know where you are on that.
Yeah.
Because when you approach these entities, you've got to know what deal you're going to take. Because if they come to you and say, we want to buy this, and you're out, pound salt, take the check and run, you've got to decide whether or not it was worth your effort to even go to them and start the conversation. Or if you're going to say, you know what, I've got to be involved. Many a good deal have died because somebody said, it's my baby. And I've seen large, I mean huge sum of monies tossed due to, and I wouldn't call it ego, because it's your baby, right? But another person would say, they offered you what? Do you want to wait for it? Are you insane? But that's pride of ownership.
Yeah, totally.
So you got to know what you want. When you approach any of these entities, or they approach you, you need to step back and say, what is my end game for this asset? Am I really somebody who's going to not want to make or sell? Am I somebody who feels like it's got to be Rick's or Locke or it's nothing else? It's got to be, you know, Patrick's shower device. Or is it, you know what? I know what it is, and if somebody writes me a large enough check, I'll go to Tahiti. And I'll sap my wounds that way.
The
floors are going to give you ideas of what these patent portfolios look like. So if you've got a patent in this type of space, let's say it's telecom, we know what a Motorola portfolio went for, but there was 2,000 patents in that portfolio. You know, these valuators will go and say, you know what, we bought this portfolio and we're going to start slicing stuff off it. This one, it's about 70 grand. This one, about 750 grand. That's their job. And so like any other buy sell, they're not going to give you full value because if they have to turn around and sell it, there has to be a margin for them.
Yeah.
So you're going to say, okay, the blue book value, let's say there's a magic blue book, the blue book value for this patent is 100K. And someone comes say, I'm going to give you 75. Well, why don't you give me 100K? Well, I got to make the margin somewhere. You have to understand that everyone's in this for the one thing, and that's the dollar. So you got to give them their due, too, because if you squeeze too hard, the deal goes away.
I mean, an interesting analogy, anyone ever watch Pawn Stars?
Yeah.
Okay, and what does the OS say? Well, I have to now sell this,
right.
And there aren't a lot of buyers. So anyone who's going to take ownership is entitled to make a profit. And yes, there's going to be some negotiation, but at the end of the day, they're taking it off your hands. You're getting a chance to make some money that you might not have otherwise, or it's the last best offer you have at the moment. So you got to put it in perspective.
We did this. This was really so you can know your options, right? There's auctions, and Lewis brought it up. So there are companies that have been around for 10, 12 years that will. That will auction off your patent for you, your highest bidder type thing. Also an option. So there's a company called Ocean Tomo, and maybe some of you have heard of it. You should check out their site. You should see how they're valuing patents, and they have their unique patented rating system where there's like a 100 and something different ways they rate a patent on, which is I can't even imagine 146 ways they can give value to a patent. So you should check it out. So there are also intellectual property advisory groups, and these are people who are probably doing what we did here tonight, so I just threw it in there just so you have an idea that they're out there. There's just so many of these companies, and we just really wanted you to just kind of be aware of them all. There's tech transfer, right? So this is a university that can take on and this is becoming more and more popular, and not just for pharmaceutical patents, but for patents and technologies that can kind of that can kind of help or not cure, just health related patents. So universities. There is a federal law that says that they can now monetize their own inventions, right? So they have professors and they have people on staff, but more and more they're looking to startups and entrepreneurs to help them start up their patents or what. They're obviously not going to get involved in maybe Francine's liquid ketamine case or anything like that. But maybe if you had something our friend here, Jason.
Yep.
Yeah, he actually presented on something 2 months ago, which was a.
Do you want to talk about it a little bit?
Yeah, it was a
shoe sanitizer.
Yeah, shoe sanitizer. So I thought it would be a good idea for him to go to some of the universities and ask them. But again, they'll take a percentage and they'll likely do some of the upfront work. This is probably your the best bet. Which is why I put the Superman picture. Venture capitalists, right? People who have loads of money and are looking to bring your product to market. These are folks that kind of hang out at meetups and stuff like that. Or if you enter a contest, or if you enter a local invention contest, usually the prize is a venture capitalist who's willing to give you some money. There are a lot of law firms that have. This is where a law firm might be able to help you. The venture capitalist may be a client, or they may actually know somebody at a law firm. So it is a who you know type of situation. But this is likely everyone's best bet here. Yeah.
Do you have a number of slides left, or how many?
No, that's it. I'm done.
Okay.
Let me just say something. Here, there's a new type of entity out there called a third party funder, and if you need help bringing a patent infringement suit, you can actually go to a third party funder. They'll take a piece of your patent and it'll actually bring them $1 million patent lawsuit. Again, something to think about. You'll have to probably give up some of your rights. All this that we're talking about kind of relates to what we were talking about in the beginning. You have to have a company, right? I mean, if you are going to accept some, if you have a patent in your own name and you want to potentially approach a licensee, they likely want to do business with a company, right? There's certain corporate structures that are more friendly to licensees / investors, right? So because for the investor who's giving you money, it's going to be a tax, it's going to be a tax implication for them, right? So they want to make sure that they are investing with a company and not an individual. So if you have not formed a company, you should try to form a company. You should be thinking about things like board of directors and stock options and shareholders agreements. There's like four major documents, and maybe Bill can help you with this. And if you're a startup, you should be really thinking about to get you ready for this monetization process, right? Shareholders agreements, confidentiality agreements, non-disclosure agreements, articles of incorporation. These are documents that you should be thinking about and you should hopefully have already.
Let me caveat that.
Sure,
actually,
sure.
I don't want to contradict
sure,
you.
Sure.
Good to know about them. If you're getting ready to be in a negotiation, definitely have it in place, but don't necessarily spend the money too early.
No, I agree, but I'm just saying for the successful patent monetization
yes.
things that I've been involved with solo inventors, eventually, right before that check is going to be cut, they're likely going to have to start a company. That's how just how it's worked out. So you might as well try to do that now. Okay, some final thoughts, and this is just we've kind of been talking about this the whole time. Licensing is not a one size fits all, right? It's going to be different for everybody. It's going to be different depending on the patent and technology. It's going to be different on who the parties are, what the IP is, what the license is going to cover, what your desire is to be part of this business or not, whether you want to exit out of it. So all these things you should be thinking about and. What Bruce was saying before. So many inventors believe they can transfer their creative expertise and experience easily into the business world, and when they can't, their egos get in the way. So I know your invention is the best thing since sliced bread, right? I know. You all should believe that and don't ever not believe that. But there comes a time where you may have to swallow some of that pride and capitulate some when it comes to actually the business part of making money off patents. So it's a hard lesson to learn, but I put it up there, and maybe I shouldn't have put 4 out of 10 startups fail and whatnot. But you should know that this is a tough business, right? This is a tough way to make money, and you know if you're going to do it at the expense of your family, oh my God, what are you doing, right? I mean, your family should come first, your loved ones should come first. So, and I say that because I've seen lives fall apart just for that, you know, just for that, license agreement. No, like that's, what are we doing here, you know? And you should have advisors. Again, they don't have to be legal, but they should be people like Bruce, people around you. You guys should be sharing stories and whatnot. And I wish you much, much luck. So,
Thank you, David. I'm sure we could have gone for another hour. But
totally.
We could take a couple of quick questions, and then we also will shift to the Wheel Tapper for additional networking and questions there.
Cool.
If anyone's interested in that. So, questions? I know we answered a lot during the course of the evening, too.
Comment. Thank you for being realistic and sharing the realism of this.
You're welcome. It's important.
I have a quick question about the opposite of technology, art, like basic art.
Yeah.
If you put it out there, it's out there, right?
Well,
if you show it to somebody who might represent you, do you have to pre-copyright anything, or do you feel like...
Listen, there are huge licensing agreements around copyright, around artwork, and around book chapters and stuff like that. So yes, I say yes.
Pre-copyright?
Pre-copyright. I have a client now that just signed a book deal with John Wiley. She wants to use her own artwork on the cover of the book. And we spoke today and I said, we should file the $50 copyright. We should do that because as soon as it gets out there, anybody's going to be able to use it, right? So you have, so IP is your right to sue, right? It's your right to, it's your right into court. So if you didn't have the copyright application or you didn't have the copyright registration on the artwork, somebody stole it, then you're SOL, you know? So yeah, pre-copyright. For $50, pre-copyright.
What if you already sent them pictures and all that, and they just threw it on good faith, file it now?
Yeah, it's never too late.
Does that help? I mean, does that help? Like in emails where you can actually trace what you said?
I mean, and the lawyers, I'm not a lawyer, but right. What I tell everyone, whatever you create is your copyrighted material. You can put circle C on anything. Whether you can sue on it, you have to have a filed copyright registration.
Yep.
You need a registration.
And you get also statutory damages,
if you
have a file.
Yeah. Within 6 months of it being off your iPhone, you better file for a registration.
Yeah.
Whoa. By the way, I had a question for the people assembled.
If you want protection on it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, like, hey.
Aside from equity crowdfunding, having a panel or a speaker about there, are there any other topics you want to hear about that don't get covered regularly here? Please.
Sort of like finding the proper manufacturer, like if you want to take this to your own business, like
mm-hmm.
how to go find the right factory, you know.
Okay.
How to find the sources, whether Mexico, China, India.
Excellent.
Yeah,
all right.
Nice.
You can speak on
that. I'd be happy to speak on that. Yeah. Okay. Any
retailer or buyers are looking for.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Retail environment. How to train yourself to work with a big box retailer.
There's a buyer that come in and say, what are they looking for?
Okay.
Pitch.
Excellent.
Is it conceivable that mm-hmm. there could be a company that kind of embodies this whole thing, where individual inventors could go and have the kind of the basics of the business all down? You know, it would be a consortium of lawyers and business people and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
So there are patent monetization firm, there's some licensing companies, right? That's how they tap themselves. But again, you'd be paying them a lot of money to probably do things that you should be doing anyway.
Okay, without
you know?
That, is there
yeah.
there a possibility that some people out there, their good graces would
would just come and do it for us, or do like maybe a case study, or to come and do it for the members?
For the members.
For the members. Oh, maybe.
Okay,
I
don't
want to. Something members.
Yeah,
don't start drooling about this, but there are some pro bono entities that I'm investigating and I'm trying to call and you know, do some due diligence on, because I don't want to just sick you on them and them on you
right.
without kind of vetting
right.
it a bit. So
yeah.
We're
right.
trying to see if there are some ways that we can provide some, help you, excuse me, not provide it, but help you find some pro bono providers. But the problem with pro bono providers is there's a quality control issue that I've seen. You know, if they're doing it for free, there's a reason, or they're doing it because they might have ulterior motives, and you really got to vet out what those ulterior motives are.
That's the problem with
yeah,
the
precisely. So, you know, it is always important to find qualified service providers who provide a good service at a reasonable price. And that's part of why we also do this.
Right.
Yes?
The gentleman has said retail, something international retail, to know if your product. We're just always worried about selling product in this country. Maybe
mm-hmm.
just the market abroad and you know, retailers
okay.
and how we can find out about that.
I think getting a retail
yeah.
buyer or two in here might be
mm-hmm.
good.
There's also wholesale distributors too. How is that different than just going directly to a store? It's a very different
mm-hmm.
wholesale agreement.
Absolutely.
This is the second time I've been to the meeting. It's been great, by the way.
Thank you.
I was hoping to catch like a couple of pitches, but I guess you didn't have anyone come by.
Yeah. I know that there was a gentleman, Jurgen, I don't know if any, no, he, I think he wants to pitch next month,
okay.
and there are a lot of people who want to pitch, but also they want to be at a good point to pitch,
sure.
you know, where they can, A, have their protections in place, and B, feel like they're making a good presentation.
Do you think that you could probably get some people who've already had successful pitches go through, come by and do
good
it all?
Point. Yes.
Okay.
There are a couple of people that have, he's not here tonight, and I think he'd love to
sure.
speak, and he has had experience talking to some of these larger retailers. Not humongous retailers, but large retailers. Yeah.
What was presented tonight seemed to be a very daunting task. One product that he wants to put out to market. Do we start with a patent? Do we start with a product designer? You go to a lawyer first, you make companies first.
Well,
it
depends! That's the next one. That's the slide you didn't see.
Yeah, and I think, let's talk. I'll give you some suggestions. Yeah, because it depends on what you have, frankly. With that, thank you again, everyone, for coming.